you want to hear the instructors talk. So I'm going to give you two brief things to think about as you go through the rest of today and you go through your season this year. The first thing is a safe sport. We are all familiar with it. We know we have to take the classes and do it. Safe sport has become, you know, we're concerned about protecting the innocent, the bullying, all these things. But what I want you to think about safe sport is a little differently. I want you to think about safe sport as becoming your personal responsibility to protect yourself. In this world, a lot of crazy things happen. Safe sport has become the new way for parents to get at officials. It used to be they scream at them, but that didn't do anything. So now everything becomes a safe sport complaint. So as you're going about your officiating, please, please, always make sure you're in a position that you can defend your actions and things that you say to somebody else, because there's going to be some parent that's not going to be happy. And even though you've done everything right, they're still not going to be happy because somehow their child has been wronged. So again, just always keep yourself, be careful what you say, be careful how you handle the players, but always put yourself in a position where you can defend yourself. That is the most important thing. Safe sport is no laughing matter. It's a great thing. It has, we hope it's going to make the sport safe for everyone, but it is very, very concerning, especially if you are the victim of somebody making a claim. So that's the first thing. Second thing is, as you all are aware, we live in very, very interesting times right now. You know, for as many of you that are on this call, there are as many different local things happening with this COVID pandemic. Some places are entirely closed. There is no officiating right now. There are no games. Some places are entirely open. I'm getting ready to step out the door and start refereeing a game. I have to wear a mask into the rink, but that's it. And then there's things in between. So please follow your local rules. And above all, do the things that make sense, common sense to you. If that means wearing a mask, great. If that means making sure you social distance from everybody, great. If that means, you know what, I don't want a referee today because I don't feel the conditions are safe, don't take that game. But please keep yourself safe in this time. This crazy pandemic thing, it affects everybody differently. And I've known a lot of people that have been very, very sick from it. Thank goodness I've not known anybody that's passed away from it. But again, you know, just because you're young and, you know, you're top of the world and don't think it can affect you, it can. And it can in a devastating way. So just don't put yourself in that situation. So that being said, again, please have a great seminar. Instructors, thank you very much for all you're doing. And I appreciate it. And I'll turn it back over to you, Z.
Thank you so much, Dewey. Don't break a leg later.
Thanks.
So I'm going to now pass it over to Melissa Scola. She is going to do just a brief staff introduction. So you'll see all your instructors today. Mo. Please.
Good morning, everybody. Thanks for being here. Over the next few minutes, you're going to be watching a video that's going to introduce all of your instructors here today. While you're watching that, we want to ask you to think about an adjective that describes yourself, but that also starts with the same letter as your first name. You'll have about 4 minutes, give or take, to think about that. We want you to insert it over into the chat function. So your first name and an adjective that starts with the same letter as your first name over in the chat function. So as you're watching ours on the very first, we'll say picture of each instructor, you'll see our name and underneath of that, the adjective that we picked for us. So I hope you guys enjoy this. Again, welcome and thanks for being here. And I can't wait to see what you guys come up with over in the chat. All right, roll that video.
Is this where I play the video?
Yeah, that video.
OK. okay, guys, first technical thing of the morning. Okay, I am playing.
You got this.
Okay.
Z, you want me to do it?
I got it. Yep.
You got it? Okay.
Everybody see that? Yes?
Like a small boat on the ocean, sending big waves into motion. Like how a single word can make a heart open. I might only have one match, but I can make an explosion. And all those things I didn't say, wrecking balls inside my brain. I will scream them loud tonight. Can you hear my voice this time? This is my fight song. Take back my life song. Prove I'm alright song. My power's turned on. Starting right now, I'll be strong. I'll play my fight song. And I don't really care if nobody else believes. Still got a lot of fight left in me. I'm losing friends and I'm chasing sleep. Everybody's worried about me. In too deep, say I'm in too deep. And it's been 2 years, I miss my home. But there's a fire burning in my bones. Still believe, yeah, I still believe. And all of those things I didn't say, wrecking balls inside my brain. I will scream them loud tonight. Can you hear my voice this time? This is my fight song. Take back my life song. Prove I'm alright song. My power's turned on. Starting right now, I'll be strong. I'll play my fight. A small boat on the ocean.
Good morning, this is Nick.
Sending big waves into motion. Like how a single word can make a heart open. I might only have one match, but I can make an explosion. This is my fight song. Take back my life song. Prove I'm alright song. My power's turned on. Starting right now, I'll be strong. I'll play my fight song. And I don't really care if nobody else believes. Cause I've still got a lot of fight left in me. Yeah, I've still got a lot of fight left in me.
Wow. So thank you all for your time. I just hope that this seminar here really inspires as we, as instructors, have been inspired. Throughout our careers as on ice officials. With that being said, we are going to go to the first topic, which is player safety and standard of play. And King Size Kelly, she is going to be going over this.
All right, let me share my screen. One
second. I love the adjectives coming in.
All right, 1 second. There you go. Can everyone see the slideshow portion?
Yes.
Okay. Oh, good. All right. Hi, everyone. I'm going to be talking pretty briefly about the player safety and standard of play. You guys are all level twos and level threes, so you've obviously been officiating for a few years, if not a number of years. So this shouldn't be anything new or life-changing, but just something we want to go over briefly today. Basically, this player safety and standard of play initiative that USA Hockey has is just a mandate that they put out to make sure that all of the games are being called consistently across the country. There's obviously a ton of hockey from the East Coast to the West Coast and the Southeast District where a lot of you guys are. So putting out this mandate that they have is their way of making sure that officials are pretty much, you know, keeping the same standard across the country. So our job as officials is to make sure that the game is called fairly and that the players are safe when playing. In order to do that, the first thing that we can do is set the standard. And what this means is basically how we call the game is setting the standard for how the players are going to play and probably how the coaches are going to react as well. So along that line, the importance of picking your first penalty is tantamount, just because, you know, you want to make sure that your first call is a good call and something that you're going to be able to stick with for the rest of the game. So the call that you're making 30 seconds into the game is going to be the same tripping call or hooking call that you're making even in overtime. Another thing to keep in mind is the level that you're officiating. Obviously, you want to, you know, keep your standard pretty much the same no matter what, but you're going to have different calls if you're repping a U8 game versus if you're repping a U19 game. And we're going to talk a little bit more about this later on, but violent penalties, those are things that you always have to take and things that USA Hockey is trying to get out of the game. Something also the NHL is focusing on is, you know, all those late hits and hits to the head and things like that. Those are penalties that no matter what the circumstance, those are things that you always have to call. And then just lastly, injury-wise, when do you blow out your whistle for an injured player in a youth game? You know, we're not doctors, or I'm not at least, we're out there to be officials. So if the player's hurt, you pretty much want to blow the whistle right away, just to be on the safe side. Just to go over our penalty criteria quickly. These are the four criteria that is pretty standard across the board. These are times when you're going to look for a possible infraction to occur. So a change of possession, loss of scoring opportunity, an obvious penalty, or a dangerous play with an injury potential. So what does this mean? Obviously, change of possession, that can occur, you know, anywhere in the rink. It's obviously probably mostly associated with restraining fouls, you know, the hooks and the trips where the player gives up the puck and the infracting player gets the puck. A loss of scoring opportunity, that's going to happen in the offensive zone and probably also is mostly associated with restraining fouls. And then the obvious penalties, you know, these are the easiest for us to gain credibility with, you know, the players and the coaches. It goes with setting the standard of play, just because if there's a trip and everybody in the rink sees it, that's an easy way for us to, you know, show everybody that we're in the game and we're paying attention and that we're there for the right reasons. So these are often, you know, the easiest calls and also great first calls to have. And then finally, just dangerous plays or plays that have injury potential. You know, this is what USA Hockey wants to get out of the game. It's not hockey. You know, there's no need for players to be hitting other players from behind, whether it's accidental or on purpose. So those things always have to be called. Zags, if you want to pull up the first poll. If anyone has problems with the polling function, just either put it in the chat or somebody will be able to help you. Thank you. So if you guys could take a second just to go through these four questions really quickly, and we'll see what you guys come up with. It doesn't look like anyone's voting. Oh, there we go. Good job, guys. Keep it going.
Sorry, mine opened up in another window and I had to go find it. So
the double monitor problem. I got that. All right. All right, we're like halfway there. Keep it going.
Yeah, ladies, this is important that you participate because it's our way of doing a knowledge check and a consciousness check.
Right. 10 more. This doesn't include us, right, Z?
No.
Okay. My screen just went out.
Oh. That's okay. We know you're still here. All right, a few more seconds, guys.
Yeah, just tell me when.
All right, we're good. Thanks, Sags. All right, so we'll just go over these quickly. Everybody got this first one right. The Declaration of Safety, Fair Play, and Respect is intended to eliminate hits from behind, hits to the head, and late hits. Obviously, things we talked about we don't want to be in the game, which is not a penalty option for a hit from behind. Almost everyone got that right. A minor, right? You can never give them just a standalone minor penalty for a hit from behind. That's one of the dangerous penalties that USA Hockey is really emphasizing that they want us to call. 100%. Wow, this group is great. The onus of changing the culture within hockey is on everyone, right? It's, you know, we can do what we can, but it's also on the players and the coaches to do their part as well. And then the last question, bench minor for unsportsmanlike conduct, banging the boards may be served by any player on the bench. This is false. It has to be a player from the ice, but that's kind of a trick question. So,
oh.
Good guessing on that. Z got it wrong, apparently. All right. So I'm going to play a quick video and let me know if you guys cannot hear this, please. Can you hear it?
Don't forget to share your sound, Kelly.
That's the key. 1 second. Sorry, folks. How do I do that again?
Get out and reshare.
Okay.
Check that box.
We did practice this, but here we are. Sorry, everyone.
For what it's worth, I've been on a ton of Zooms because of COVID, you know, and people that, you know, you don't normally do it, and you guys are doing awesome. So,
thanks. All right, this should be fixed.
That's why Stacey will not be doing national hockey videos.
2009.
Is this me talking?
I'm National Hockey League Liaison Brian Murphy. For the 2019-20 season, USA Hockey is implementing a new declaration of player safety, fair play, and respect. The purpose of body checking is to gain possession and control of the puck and not to intimidate or punish an opponent. There are three main components to the new declaration. First, there are no late hits. A player must have possession and control of the puck in order to deliver a legal body check. Second, no hits to the head. Third, no hits from behind. A player in a vulnerable and defenseless position cannot be legally body checked. USA Hockey is focused on the development and player safety of their participants.
All right, so we basically just went over what I've been talking about, things that we want to eliminate and keep out of the game. It's obviously important for game management also, because that's how, you know, games start to get out of control, is if these hits happen and, you know, we don't penalize them, that's when we're going to start losing control of the game. So basically, how do we as officials help maintain the safe and fair playing environment. Communication is our biggest tool, right? As referees, we want to communicate with the coaches and the players and also our partner so that everybody's on the same page. A very easy way to diffuse situations is to talk to the players. You know, they're out there because they want to play the game, and, you know, we're out there because we want to be part of it, but we don't want to insert ourselves if it's not necessary. So just talking to the players, especially the youth players, they're usually pretty reasonable and they're willing to listen if you tell them not to do something. So use our communication tools, and then also with our partner. We're never alone out there. We always have partners that we can rely on or discuss things with. So make sure that you talk with your partner before the game, or if something happens during the game, don't be afraid to take a second to talk to your partner and use them as a resource. There is no more letting them play or putting the whistle away. That's something that USA Hockey doesn't stand behind. You know, obviously putting your whistle away and not calling penalties that should be penalized isn't really letting the best team win. Our job is to make sure that everybody's, you know, playing fairly and following the rules. So if we just don't call any penalties, we're affecting that, even if we think we aren't. So just to summarize, we want to enforce the same standard at all the levels that we're officiating, but obviously adjust to that level as well. And make sure that we are calling the violent penalties, especially the hits to the head and the hits from behind and the late hits. And that's all I have. Back to you, Z.
Thanks, Kelly. All right, we are running on schedule. So I'm going to go over zero tolerance and 601. It's kind of building off of Kelly's player safety and standard of play, because we have this really cool rule called 601. My presentation is going to be about 15 minutes, and then we'll have a 10-minute breakout session. And after that, we'll take a 5-minute break. All right, let me share my screen here. Everybody see that? Yes, okay. All right, so USA Hockey is committed to creating a safe and fair environment for all participants. Last year, USA Hockey came out with a directive that updated the zero tolerance policy. I think most of you would have gotten that memo. On abuse of officials and unsportsmanlike conduct. And that update placed additional responsibilities on not just the teams and administrators, but also the officials to do their part in contributing to a positive environment. So part of that, what we can do to make that positive environment is to introduce ourselves, just right off the bat, introducing ourselves to the coaches for both teams prior to the start of the game. Okay, and it's an excellent opportunity to build rapport and establish communication expectations. It's also a great opportunity to go over any COVID specific stuff for that rink, right? Some rinks may say, hey, kids can't use the penalty boxes. They have to sit here or there. We're not going to do handshakes. So just go over to the coach and start that line of communication. Okay. We are expected to properly enforce the rules, obviously, but the emphasis last year by USA Hockey was really to uphold 601, and I'm going to go over that. It might seem a little dry. There are a lot of options under 601, so just bear with me. I will also be randomly calling on people in our little square thing on the screen. So just like in a game, how we should be on our toes and be constantly aware, just be ready for me to call on you, especially you Southeast District girls. Okay, so before I get into each of those options, some general overarching guidelines. We have bench minor penalties that shall be assessed for actions that occur on, you know, in the immediate vicinity of the player's bench. We have a minor misconduct penalty option for stuff that occurs on the playing surface. Actions committed by players who are on the player's bench, and you can readily identify them, we can go straight to the misconduct. Okay, we'll get more into that. And then actions that occur at the end of the game shall first be penalized by a misconduct for a player, or if the coach is mouthing off again at the end of the game, they'll be assessed a bench minor. Okay, and again, any questions that you guys have, please send them to the chat, and either Jenny or Melissa will take care of those. And Jenny and Melissa, feel free to interrupt if there are any great questions. So our first option under 601 is a minor penalty, okay? A minor penalty for unsportsmanlike conduct can be assessed to a player for the following actions. Number one, if they challenge or dispute the ruling of any official, if they taunt or incite an opponent, if they create a disturbance during the game, if they shoot the puck after the whistle, if in your opinion that shot was avoidable. Okay, so if that's, if they, you know, shoot it in the direction of the goal after the play was stopped, you can ding them with a two. Okay, so I'm going to go to my squares here. Oh, I love this. I feel so powerful. Okay, let's go to Tasha. Yes. Good morning, Tasha.
Morning, Z.
Okay. So a player is assessed a minor penalty for tripping and does not proceed immediately to the bench while disputing the call. Should any additional penalty be called?
Yes, on sportsmanlike.
On top of the
2 minute for tripping.
Yes. Okay. Very good. Okay. Back to mute. Okay. Thank you, Tasha. Yes. So again, we can have the original tripping penalty and then you can ding them with an additional two. Okay. All right. Going back. All right. The next option we have is a bench minor. A bench minor shall be assessed to any team whose players who you can't identify or obviously team officials, commit the following actions. So pretty much the same actions, okay? If they're disputing a ruling of any official, if they're using obscene, profane, or having abusive language. Number three, if they use your name in a loud or abusive manner. Four, if they throw any object into the playing area during the progress of the game or during a stoppage of play. So number two, you know, hey ref, hey Z, you suck. You know, whether it's true or not, I don't know, but still, that's not very sportsmanlike. So go ahead and ding him with the two. That's BS, use of the F-bomb, stuff like this. More things that they can do to earn themselves a bench minor. If they're banging the stick with the, banging the boards with their stick, including their, you know, skates or arms, after a body check, regardless to whether the check is being penalized, you can ding them with a bench, okay? Number six, if they're using threatening or abusive language or gestures, I mean, not this gesture, but other gestures, right? Or seven, interfering in any non-physical manner with the game official, including the off-ice guys in the performance of their duties. Something like, you know, squirting the water bottle. I've had that before. The next option you have can go to a misconduct penalty, okay? Misconduct penalty shall be assessed to any player who commits the following actions. If they're persisting in any conduct where they were previously already assessed on unsportsmanlike. Again, if they're using obscene, profane, or abusive language to any person anywhere in the rink before, during, or after a game. Intentionally knocking or shooting the puck out of reach of an official, I hate that, who's retrieving it during a stoppage of play. Okay, very rude. I'll go back to my squares here. Be ready. Be ready. Let's see. Victoria studiously taking notes over there. Okay, Victoria, you ready?
Sure.
Okay. A player sitting on the player's bench uses profanity towards an official. If the official can recognize the player using this language, can she assess a misconduct penalty rather than a bench minor?
So you're asking if we recognize which player it is in the bench?
Yes.
Well, if you recognize what player it is in the bench, wouldn't it not be a bench minor? Because the player is identifiable?
You are saying the right things. Let's pick the right penalty.
So right. Misconduct, if he persists.
Yes. So you can assess a misconduct penalty rather than a bench. Even though it's happening on the bench, if you can readily identify that bad dude, yes, you can go straight to a 10. Okay? If you can't, if you just hear it over on the bench, then yeah, you got to go with the 2.
Okay.
Does that make sense to everybody? Everybody nod heads. Yeah. That's okay. Ooh, I get to pick another person. Yes.
Good job, Victoria. That was a hard one, and there was a good talking through the situation. So good word is good thinking.
Okay. We're not, let's see. Monica.
I'm here.
Okay, Monica. Sunny Florida. Okay.
Kinda.
Oh, is it not sunny? Okay.
Yeah, rainy.
Okay.
It'll be sunny in like 5 minutes, so it's fine.
Okay. That's great. Okay. So what penalty is imposed on a player who collides with you as an official and verbally abuses you for being in the way with no reference being made to a previous decision?
But it's not profanity, but it's they're still just like yelling at you.
Yes, you got in their way, or they think you got in their way. They're not disputing a ruling.
Yeah.
You got in their way.
And now they're just being a jerk.
And they're verbally abusing you, yes.
But they're on the ice. Mm-hmm. I guess since it's not a bench minor because they're not on the bench, and it's not just a minor because they're not just like challenging a rule, and they made contact and now they're being a jerk. So I guess it's another misconduct.
Yes. Southeast District. Yes. Okay. Okay. Control yourself, Z. Okay. Yes. Yes. Thank you, Monica. Very good. So since the player is not disputing a ruling, the verbal abuse does fall under misconduct. I love how you thought through that. Thank you. Okay. Some other things that could fall under 601 for misconduct: not proceeding directly and immediately to the penalty bench or to the dressing room. 5, if they're entering or remaining in the referee's crease. Do we all know where the referee's crease is? Yes, okay. It's that semicircle right by the scorekeeper, right? Obviously you don't just go straight to a 10 if they're encroaching, but you know, hey guys, back up a little bit. 6, interfering in any non-physical manner with any on-ice, off-ice game official in the performance of their duties. Stuff like if you're standing by their bench and they kind of put their arm out as you're skating by, stuff like that. You know, not punching you or hitting you, but just interfering in general. Then there are some things, people just do bad things in this world. There are some things that can earn you either, you have an option between misconduct or game misconduct, okay, based on the severity of their actions, okay? When you're a referee, you're just very judgmental out there, okay? So you have the option of misconduct or game misconduct if they're touching or holding you with their hand or stick, okay? 2, if they attempt to continue an altercation after they've been ordered to stop, or they resist the linesman in stopping the altercation. 3, if they're intentionally banging the board or protective glass or goal frame with their stick at any time. Okay, so that's just any time. If done in protest of your decision, an additional minor foreign sportsmanlike conduct shall also be assessed. Okay, we're gonna go to heads up, guys. Ladies. Okay. Michelle LeClaire, former Southeast District. Can you unmute yourself? Okay. You ready for this?
Yes.
Okay. So a fight breaks out between two opposing players. The referee rushes to the scene and orders the players to stop it. The linesmen have not yet arrived to break up the fight. Should each player receive an additional misconduct or game misconduct penalty for continuing the fight after being ordered to stop?
Yes.
So this is, I will say that this is a hard question, okay? So the answer is no. Because this is a good example. Thank you, Michelle, for taking a step. So the spirit and intent of the rule is to assess the proper penalty in cases where the players have already been physically separated, okay? Or one or more of those players attempts to continue the altercation after blatantly ignoring our instructions, okay? So the referee is ordering them to stop, right? They're still fighting, okay? You don't just throw them the additional misconduct or game misconduct because they really haven't been separated yet. They're still going at it, okay? Had they already stopped fighting and then they get back into it, that's when you can assess the additional 10 or game, okay? Or if the linesmen were there, because that's the key to the question, the linesmen hadn't yet arrived. If the linesmen, for example, Erica's she's a little bit too fast, too hot, so she's going to get there. She will definitely be there. If Erica's there already trying to separate them, and me as the referee, which is not a good thing, by the way, me as a referee trying to tell them to stop, and she's in there trying to pull them apart, then you can go ahead and assess them, because she's there. It's a little technical thing. Okay, going to you non-Southeast people think you're safe, but you're also not safe. Let's see here. Okay, we'll go to Rachel Barr. Thank you. Okay. Rachel Barr. Okay, a goalkeeper or player bangs his stick on the glass at the goal judge after a disputed goal. What penalty must be assessed? He's banging his stick on the glass at the goal judge.
Goal judge.
So who's considered an off-ice official?
A misconduct?
Yes. He automatically gets the misconduct for banging his stick. And but the goal judge has also done something, right? He's assessed that goal. He's turned on that light for the goal.
So then an additional minor penalty?
Yes. Yes. Thank you, Rachel. Yes. So goal judge, like I was hinting at, it's considered part of the officiating team. So any protest directed at him or her would be penalized in a normal manner. So that additional 2. Okay? So 10 for banging their stick, you know, and the additional 2 because they're protesting at a decision. Okay, another option, let's go back here. So these go straight to a game. There's no option for a misconduct. These kind of things go straight to a game. I keep repeating myself, okay. Number 1, if they're persisting in any course of conduct for which they've previously been assessed a misconduct or bench minor for a team official. Okay, this is important to remember. Sometimes they can trip me up, okay. So if it's a player, we have, for under 601, we can go 2, 10, game, right? And if they keep going, then we can warn the captain, and then we can go to bench. But the main thing is for a player, you go 2, and they keep going, 10, and they keep going, and game, 2, 10, game. For a coach or other team official, it's going to be bench, game. There's no 10 option in there. Okay, so player, 2-10 game, coach, bench, game. Also, if they're using an obscene gesture anywhere in the rink before, during, or after the game, these gestures are probably very obscene. They go straight to the game. Okay, so we all can think of different examples of those. We'll go back to our screens.
Z, I have a question on the chat too, whenever you have a minute.
Oh yeah, go ahead, please.
Okay, so in the chat, we have a good question that came up. It says, if a player does not go straight to the penalty box, they get an unsportsmanlike first, right? And then it says, is there any situation where you would issue two misconducts sequentially? So two questions there. Did we get that?
Yeah.
Okay.
So yes, they would get, if they're refusing to go to the box after they've been called, so they'll get, it's kind of like Tasha's question. So she had the original tripping, and then she gave him a two for unsportsmanlike.
I asked that. It's just that in the book, it goes from section C, it says not proceeding directly falls under a misconduct. So I didn't know, do you give them the extra two, or officially you would give them a misconduct?
I would go two. I mean, unless they're continuing to not go to the box, then you can ding them with the 10. I mean, the first thing I would do it actually is talk to them. You really need to get to the box. Hint, hint. You know.
And yeah, but if they're like, I mean, if they're hot about the penalty and they're just, if they're just not going to do it, I mean, you give them another two, they're not doing it. And yeah, I mean, the book says it's a straight up misconduct.
Just go to the 10. That's a good question. And the other one is if you can assess two misconducts at the same time.
Correct.
I mean, I don't see where that would happen unless you have like a hit from behind or head contact where it already comes with a two and a 10 plus a 10 for not proceeding to the box. I'm not sure when you would go 10 and 10. You would probably go 10 and then the game.
I'd agree with that.
Awesome. Yeah.
Standing there and dinging them with the 10, 10, 10, 10, 10.
I think what the situation they're looking for might be 601 situation 3.
Okay. Could you read that for us?
It's where they say there's a minor misconduct, a game misconduct, a warning to the captain, a bench minor, and then I've got notes in here where it says a refusal to start play protocol from previous seminars. It's about where the proper sequence when a referee is being verbally abused, but it also falls under where a player refuses to proceed to the penalty box. It would be the same protocol.
Right. I don't think it's double jeopardy. I think you just keep them really clear. Just categorize them 2, 10, game. Because by the time they get to that 10, they're going to get tossed the next thing they do, game.
Yeah, it says now, can they get multiple? Receives their second misconduct shall be assessed a game in lieu of a second misconduct.
Right, so yeah, you have that as well. Thank you, little Z.
Hey, Z, this is Jen. I got a comment on that.
Yes.
So hypothetically, you got a situation, maybe let's just say it's a tripping and you've called the tripping. Then before they start heading to the box, maybe they start questioning it, which maybe could be deemed as they're refusing to go. Maybe not yet. But in 601A, it's a minor penalty for challenging or disputing a ruling. So I guess there's a possibility you could have the two for the tripping, and then they start kind of questioning you before they aren't really going to the box. It could go another two. And then, you know, as you're still trying to get them to the box, then proceed to a misconduct. Would you be in agreement with something like that?
Yep.
Yeah, okay. All right.
Yep. Good question.
Give a quick chime in too. And then also just, I mean, these are really good questions and it's a situation that seems to be escalating kind of quick. So if any of us do find ourselves in an instance where someone is very upset with the call that we've made and is kind of talking back and forcing our hand to start making some of these calls, we do want to try to be aware not to maybe bait them. And even though we might not be talking, maybe you've already started to realize they're upset, they're starting to talk back, you might have to start giving some calls. Maybe we skate away for a little bit and try to let our linesmen and our partners escort them to those penalty bench areas. Anytime we can kind of diffuse the situation and have less escalation. It's just to all of our benefit. So that's all.
Yeah, thanks, Jenny. All right, so moving on. For other things they might do to earn them a game. Again, if they're interfering in any physical manner with a game official. And number four, as the other Z talked about, a second misconduct can actually, that's changed to a game misconduct. So on the score sheet, be careful when you're checking that Jane Smith doesn't have two misconduct. So she gets a 2 and a 10 for head contact, and then she's complaining profusely to you and abusing you verbally, that's actually changed to a game misconduct. Okay, she's not going to have a 2 and a 10 for checking from behind or whatever, hit to the head, and then a second misconduct. I think oftentimes the scorekeepers will write misconduct, so just make sure you check those game sheets that second misconduct becomes a game misconduct.
What if someone doesn't remember and they forget to issue the game?
Yeah, so it's depending on, the question is if someone forgets to write that's the game misconduct on the sheet. So I guess it depends. At the end of the game, if you're checking the score sheet and you see, you can go ahead and write that in. If you completely forget, then you're going to have to file a supplemental report with USA Hockey. So you have the initial game report, and then you have another supplemental report saying that should have been assessed. All right. We might not have time to go to the breakout sessions just because I see a break's coming up. I'm going to wrap up here, and then we'll go to a break. But before I do, I have a couple more slides left. We are going to go to Caitlin Holden. Caitlin.
Hi.
All right, so if a player on Team A reaches into the timekeeper's bench and turns off the game clock, what penalty is assessed?
Misconduct?
Even more.
Game
misconduct? Yes, they're physically interfering with an off-ice official, the timekeeper, in performing their duties. All right, that's really affecting the whole game. So yeah, we actually go game on that. Thanks, Caitlin. Okay, the last option we have is a match penalty. Everybody show me the match penalty signal. We should all. Is it your left hand or right hand? I'm just kidding, it's either hand. Okay, so a match penalty shall be assessed to a player or team official who commits the following actions. Okay, this builds off of that zero tolerance memo that came out. So any language that's offensive, hateful, or discriminatory in nature, anywhere in the rink before, during, or after the game, we're required to assess that match penalty and file that game report. Okay, if the incident was reported to us, okay, but not heard by the officials, we're still required to notify the coach and the offending team of the offending team and submit an incident report. Okay, so if a player comes up to me and says, hey, I heard so-and-so call so-and-so a such-and-such, okay, I can't assess that match penalty, right? I either have to hear it, or if I'm reffing, the linesmen have to report it to me, okay, any on-ice official. Even if a timekeeper reports it to me, it has to be, I believe, an on-ice official. Someone correct me if I'm wrong. So what I do then, if a player reports it to me that so-and-so said such-and-such to whoever, I have to go to the offending team's coach. I'm going to say, hey, so-and-so said such-and-such and da-da-da-da-da. And then I go to the other coach, because the other coach is now wondering what I said to that coach, and I tell him, yeah, so-and-so said such-and-such. And then I also file a game report. You're not, even though you're not assessing a penalty, USA Hockey is pushing for us to report these things because the affiliate wants to review these incidents, okay? So they're, whether they're penalized or unpenalized, just be just go ahead and file that report, because they want to kind of keep track of these things. Okay, so if they hear multiple things of so-and-so on such-and-such team saying such-and-such bad things, bleepity bleepity bleep, that they, you know, maybe they'll put two and two together. It's not a comedy show, guys. Just no laugh. If I if you're laughing, I told you to unmute yourself, okay? Okay. All right, moving on. So other obvious things, if they're deliberately inflicting physical harm, okay, to you, if they sucker punch you in the face, okay, if they spit in your face, match penalty. If they're deliberately injuring or attempting to do so to another player, okay, match. And if they're behaving in a manner that's critically detrimental to the conducting of the game, match. Okay. My last question for the audience, the lucky random person. I'm just going to go Jocelyn. Call my little sister. Okay.
I'm busy asking questions in the chat.
Oh, someone please get that chat, please. Okay.
No, it was
all
me.
So, Z, the referee hears a coach instructing his players to get an opponent, otherwise interpreted as intentionally fouling the opponent for purposes of intimidation or physical harm. Can the referee assess a match penalty?
If me as a referee determines that he is behaving in a manner that is critically detrimental to the conducting of the game.
You just heard him tell his player to go get an opponent, and you really know what he means by get.
I don't know how I would defend that, how I really knew that, except that I could just say it felt like to me that he was behaving in a manner that is critically detrimental to the conduct of the game.
So the answer to that is yes. So the referee assesses a match penalty, okay? Because you can interpret that as threatening the opponent, even though there's no threat made directly to the opponent. Note that this applies only if directed toward an opponent. If a coach, for some reason, tells his player to go get another player, one of his players, there's no provision under that rule, okay? So yeah, I think you could just measure that by the temperature of the game, obviously. Okay, so summary.
Could you otherwise give it something less if you heard something and give the coach a bench?
No, because match, also there's the attempt to deliberately inflict harm. So if you saw like another player try to stomp on a girl's neck and she completely misses the neck, you still assess that match, right? Okay, so in summary, you guys can read, okay? We're all in this together under 601, all right? Please enforce it. Remember, zero tolerance is zero tolerance. Big zero, okay? The abuse is only gonna stop if we call it. And if we don't shut it down, who will? Okay, so as level two officials now, for some of you are level twos, threes going in, so you're gonna be working higher level games, and with higher level games, there's higher level what? Emotions, right? So you still gotta allow for that gray area of release valve. I think you draw the line where it comes to profanity, obscene gestures, abusive behavior, okay, and conduct that openly challenges authority. All right, so I kind of ran over, but I think we had a great discussion. Thank you guys for listening. We're going to take Zags. We're going to take a 5-minute break. So let's come back at 10:05.
I think so.
I'm gonna share my screen here. Are you guys able to see?
Yes.
Awesome. All right, so in following up to 601, right, definitely an area that we do need to be familiar with, and obviously a lot of different situations. Some making us pretty confident, others a little uncomfortable, right? So these are things, as you continue to develop, you will be expected to know, but please be aware that there are all sorts of resources that USA Hockey provides us in addition to just the rule book and the case book, that can help grow our toolbox and get us more familiar and comfortable when these hard situations arise. So a lot of this starts with the various camps that USA Hockey offers. Let's see what number. And my computer doesn't seem to be letting me switch. Oh, there we go. All right, so these officiating development camps are designed to improve your officiating skills and prepare you for those more challenging games and game assignments. It's going to provide all the participants with those fundamental skills, both on and off ice instruction, that you're going to be needed or that are needed, and you can return those to your grassroots home communities and be the best officials that you can be. So some of the pretty straightforward basic camps that we have are various district camps hosted by different areas, the Women's Futures Camp, and the Elite Experience. So this is a caption of a Years Past Southeast District Camp. You can see participants in the red, instructors in the blue, and you know, it's a good time. So let's talk about that. All right, so district camps are meant to combine both advanced officiating education while enhancing the experience and working games at the player's district development level. So now all of a sudden you're not necessarily getting to work just in-house and travel games, you're getting to see what games are like at the next level. So at these district camps, you'll get both on and off ice instruction. Typically, the ages are going to range from about 18 years old and up. You're going to be able to, so the overall officiating minimum recommended experience is 2 to 3 years, which would probably match just about everyone in this seminar right now. And then one thing is, it is important to note that not all districts do offer this, so that's a little unfortunate, but you can attend other district camps. So by getting to learn us and reach out to the seminars, even in this, or the instructors in this call right now, if your local district doesn't host one, I'm sure we can help and get you pointed into the right direction. All right, so summer development camps. We have the Futures and the Elite Experience. So Futures Camp. The objective here is going to be to establish and reinforce practical understanding of the fundamentals of game management at all levels of amateur hockey. So when you attend a Futures Camp, it's about a week long. It covers positioning, rule knowledge, skating, mental preparation, goal setting, physical fitness. Some of the requirements or some of the facts are typically it's 12 to 18 participants. The ages range from about 18 to 28, but again, it's not limited to those ages. Overall, again, you need about 2 to 3 years of officiating experience to attend this. And they're looking for people that possess a strong desire to bring this information that they receive at the camp back to their local communities. Another thing to note for the Futures Camp, so housing, meals, facility use, and the classroom materials are all going to be provided by USA Hockey, which is awesome. And the participants only pay a registration fee and for their travel to get to and from that camp location. So just a pretty much the same information on this slide, but it is important to note that there's also a Futures Camp for sled hockey. So if that's something that interests you, that's another great way to get involved with the sport. This is a newer and smaller sort of camp, typically 6 participants. The ages range a little more broad in this sense, but again, it's not exclusive to 18 to 36. And they do recommend that it is participants with both prior experience in the sled hockey realm and also in the competitive able-bodied hockey realm. And then the rest of the stuff, bringing the information you learn back to your local areas, and then again the same costs and fees for this one. All right, the Elite Officiating Experience. So this one, to identify international officiating candidates and to train them in the playing rules, the procedures, and mechanics of the International Ice Hockey Federation, otherwise known as the IIHF. This one typically takes place in Lake Placid, New York. It's a week-long program, and it highlight and the highlights include officials' practices and getting to work games at the USA Hockey player prospect level, which is a pretty high level. It's a great camp to work. So other takeaways from getting to work any of these various camps: you get to be part of a very unique officiating experience. Feedback and supervision that you're going to receive comes from experienced staff. These people have all gone through what you're going through, and they've worked their way up, same as you guys are doing right now. It's also something that's going to serve as a stepping stone to your next level. There are various leadership and mentoring opportunities that arise from this. So although many of us might be level twos and level threes in here and thinking that you're still getting to know the game and building the game yourself, by attending one of these camps, you now have the tools in your toolbox to be able to start supporting and mentoring other newer and younger officials as well. And one of the, kind of for me, the biggest things is the various friendships that you're going to make when you attend these camps. They're lifelong friendships. And what's really cool is you're going to meet people both from USA Hockey officiating and even some international officials that attend our camps. If you are interested in learning more about officiating development or in participating in one of these camps, so there's a couple steps that you can take. So obviously, I think step one could be to contact anyone in the seminars, in this seminar for more information. So the staff here is more than happy to help or point you into the right direction. You could also go to the USA Hockey website and contact your district evaluator or state supervisor. Again, great people to point you in the right direction. Or you can also contact your district RIC, referee in chief. Before kind of moving on, I don't know if there's any questions in the chat bar because I just have this on the screen to cover. Nope, awesome.
I had a question.
Sure.
I was just wondering, are there any plans to increase the number of women at a district's camp instead of like one or two, or make a women's only district camp?
So I think with the numbers growing within the game, that's definitely something to look for. Us hosting this women's only seminar right now obviously shows that the game is growing. It's growing for female officials, and that's a positive thing that hopefully we can kind of piggyback off of and continue to grow and develop. And again, not only the staff in this call, but I think it also comes to all of you participants here to be reaching out to your various local areas and trying to encourage younger girls and female official or players to get involved, to get into officiating, because the more we have, the more likely that those opportunities are going to be able to be available. So I think that's a great question. Thank you.
Cool. Yeah, I did the women's futures a couple years back, and I wanted to do the district, but I see the notice come out. It's like, oh, we want at least one woman. I'm like, well, I'm not going to be the only one. So, you know, it's like if we could get like 50%, you know, on the district camp to be women, like that would be a much better environment, I think. And then we could have even numbers, like Jack said.
Of course. Yes, it can be intimidating to be the one or one of few. So, of course, as we continue to grow in our area of the game, I think that's going to be something that we'll be pushing for as we continue. All right. So, as part of our amazing staff here, we have two Olympians, Stacy Livingston and Melissa Moe. I can never say it right, or Scola. And so Stacy, a little quick background for her. She has done two Olympic Games. Hopefully this is all correct. If not, any of you guys chime in. Both as a referee and a supervisor in 2002 and 2014. And then Mo was a referee at the most recent Olympic Games in 2018. So just to give a quick little glimpse into their experience at the Olympics, we've got some photos here, both Mo and Stacy, individual and in their groups. And then also to show that, you know, it's not always on ice experiences and fun. if I can get this to switch. But right, it is a group effort. It is collaborative. We get to have both on and off ice experiences. So definitely some great things to aspire to one day. So we are gonna have a brief Q&A here with our Olympians. And to start off, one of our first questions is, how did you first get started into officiating?
Mo, you going first or am I going first?
You can go.
I got started in officiating because I played at University of Maine and I needed beer money. That's the truth. So I started in men's hockey. At night, I would go and do the men's games, make $100 cash, do that 3 and 4, 5 times a week. And that was a lot of pocket money for a college kid. So yeah, that's how I started officiating. Top that, Mo. Go for it.
Mine isn't that fun. my now husband, at the time boyfriend, was an official already, and we were watching the Wings play, and his seminar was that night. And of course, when you first start dating something, you want to do everything together. So he took me to a seminar, and that's how it started. So, you know, just wanted to hang out with the boyfriend a little bit.
Super romantic right there.
Super romantic. If we had time for my engagement story, it'd be even better.
Yeah.
Maybe we'll save that one for the end, but definitely consider that. All right, so on to the next question here. So can you guys describe what your journey to make it to the Olympics look like? And then just kind of a sidebar, did you always know that you wanted to officiate the Olympics?
Go ahead, Stace.
All right, just because I'm older and it's been longer. Yeah, exactly. No, I did not know that I was going to go to the Olympics. I wasn't even on my radar. I mean, like I said, I started in college hockey and I officiated college hockey. I went to all the nationals for USA Hockey. And then all of a sudden, you know, I was under with Matt and I went to all the camps that Jenny was talking about. I went to my first camp at 17 and it was a 17 to 45, 48 year old was the difference. So that was the age span. There was 30 of us. We stayed like in a cabin in Lake Placid. It wasn't even at the training center because the training center wasn't there. So I worked under Matt and I kept doing tournaments and stuff. And he's like, hey, there's this thing called the IHF and I want you to go there and be a part of that and do world championships and travel around. The funny part is I did all my training in the U.S. because the Olympics were in the U.S. at the time of the training. So the big joke around is that I've done the highest level of hockey when I was refereeing and stuff, but I never left the U.S. I only left the U.S. after I retired and became a officiating coach. So, yeah, I mean, I never knew I wanted to officiate the Olympics. And I think my journey is probably a little bit different than Mo's just because of where girls hockey and women's hockey is today. There's a lot more spotlight on it. There's a lot more opportunities. There was little opportunities, and all the opportunities I got it through USA Hockey. And does that answer your question, Jenny, or do you want some more detail?
No, that's perfect. Awesome. Thank you. Mo, how about you?
I kind of decided I wanted to make the Olympics a go at my second game I ever officiated. So I almost quit after my first game. And then during my second game said, I'm going to make it to the Olympics. So yes, my story is a little bit different. The journey took quite a while for me. I went to my first camp at 26 years old. Moved my wedding to go to camp because otherwise I would have gotten home on the day of my wedding. And it took me basically 10 years to go through that whole process from my first camp to the actual Olympic Games. So unlike Stacy, I was able to do, I think, 9 international tournaments before the Olympic Games. And only one of them was here in the States. So I've had a lot of opportunity to, like Jenny said, meet a lot of great people around the world. and work so many different levels of international hockey as well as here in the U.S. So my journey was definitely a long journey, and I learned so much over those years, taking 10 years to get that far. And for those of you who don't know me well at all, I did not play hockey growing up, so that's a whole nother story. But my figure skating career took my skating level up a little bit higher. So learning the game, being around the game, and having people like Stacy as supervisors and others, definitely lots of other supervisors along the way to teach and give feedback, was what really kind of made it happen for me.
That's awesome. Thank you guys. So next question here. What is one of your most memorable officiating experiences? So Stacy, if you wanna hit the ground running first.
Well, one would think it would be, I got the opportunity to ref the gold medal game in the 2002 Olympic game. And everybody would say, oh, that's probably your most memorable officiating experience. I would have to say no. And it's not really a experience or a memory I'm going to go to, but I'm going to refer back to that video that you guys put together for this seminar. And I sat there and I had the biggest smile on my face, because I can remember probably 80% of those pictures when you guys were on the ice, off the ice, experiences. And I would just say is my most, if I was to retire from officiating coaching today, my most memorable experience for officiating in general would be the people, the places, and the opportunities that I've had to do. That is worth way more than any game I have been involved in, any game I have played. I don't know. I mean, you could go back to the recording and see my face during the video. I was so proud of each and every one of the instructors that you guys put together. I was just really proud, because I've had the opportunity to be somewhat little involvement of where you guys go, where you guys have been, and that just makes me a lot more proud than any game I've done. That's a lot of feelings, Jenny, for like a Sunday morning for Livingston.
You know, we gotta wake you up here.
I mean, seriously. Mo?
If you gotta wake up, at least it's to something like that.
Exactly.
I think I'm crying over here.
No. Oh my God, Z, get it together. Are you serious? Okay, where's the other Z? Z Jr., where are you?
What happened?
No tears.
Oh, she's on a break. She's not even paying attention.
No, I'm paying attention. I don't know what my sister did, though.
She's sensitive. She's crying. Are you a crier?
Exactly. She's crying?
Yes.
Wait, what?
Hey, welcome to the seminar, Jocelyn. Come on, pay attention.
Hi. I didn't know crying was part of it.
No, don't do that.
Okay.
All right, moving on, Mo. Sorry. Okay. Go ahead.
I agree with Stacy, as my most memorable experience has nothing to do with the Olympics, although that was absolutely incredible. My favorite experience was just last year, I think it was last year, during the rivalry series, USA and Canada. And here in Michigan, we had a game at, I always want to say the Joe, but that's gone. So at Little Caesars Arena. And I was able to bring 4 local officials that are relatively new to come in the locker room with us, to get a tour of Little Caesars, to skate our hard lap at the beginning of the game, and stand with us during the national anthem. And Z, I'm with you because it makes me want to cry and I have goosebumps, but to see the look on those girls' faces to do that, that's what I live for. To help you guys achieve your dreams, even if it's through mine, I don't know if that makes sense, is my absolute favorite part. I love to give back and to teach and to help you guys achieve whatever dream that might be of yours. And their faces, I mean, All the feels.
Great way to start the morning. All right, moving on. So was it challenging to be one of the few female officials throughout your officiating career? And obviously our game continues to grow with female officials, but even, you know, in this call as previously mentioned, it still can be a factor in our game. So how was that for yourselves throughout your career? Stacy?
Yes, it was challenging. There's my answer.
Okay.
No, I'm kidding. yeah, I think it was challenging just because, like I said before, it's like there was a lot less few, there was a less female officials than there are now. There was less education, there was less opportunity. So I definitely felt like we are out there on an island by ourselves some days, but some days, you know, going to the rink and having all the guys support too. I really interact really well with guys. I get their sense of humor. So I had no problem fitting in there. But I would say challenging would be just through the education that with women's hockey and women's officials. I think that was really challenging to teach people and educate that part of the game. But yeah, I just, it is what it is. It's still challenging for female officials. And you just either have to go with it or go do basketball. I don't know what to tell you.
Yeah.
Right?
No, that's a great answer. And I think and I hope that as we do a seminar like this today, you know, women only, that we make that challenge a little less for all of us together. Because
absolutely,
we are a sisterhood and we're not alone, even if we might feel like we are in our local areas. We have people that we can reach out to.
See, you don't need me. You could have just answered that question.
I got inspired by the response based on your response. So there
okay.
You go.
Yeah, nice try. Go ahead, Mo.
Yeah, I definitely think it's a challenge, but I think that challenge has improved and just changed in a sense from maybe your experience going through your career compared to where it is now. I've definitely had challenges, but I wouldn't say there was, for me anyways, anything that took it to the level of this disrespect is out of control. It always challenged me to know my rule book better or to approach a situation differently. They were never personal attacks for me. It was something that had I known or had a little more instruction or experience with it, that the outcome would have been different. So it was taking each of those little pieces and going home after the game and figuring out what kind of went wrong, if you want to call it that. So there were times that were definitely disheartening and difficult, but I always felt supported and felt like there was something I could do to make the situation better. So I think it changes. Like Stacy said, there's so much more opportunity and so many more women now that we are still going to have challenges, but how can we make them better? And doing seminars like this to me is one of the biggest steps into improving that and making these connections. So we can reach out to people in those tough times and say, hey, Stace, I had a really difficult situation. I'm not sure what I could have done differently. I need to talk to you about this and figure out how I can be better. And now you've got, how many people are on this call? 42 people, 42 more women that you can reach out to in those situations. So it's really pretty cool to think about it in that sense. So.
Absolutely. So to wrap us up with this Q&A session, if you guys could give us any tips or advice, what would that be?
I'll be serious for a second. I was going to say something, but I won't. I think the piece of advice that I would give you is make hockey part of your world. Don't make hockey your world. There's other parts to your life and your family, your friends, your opportunities. Make hockey part of that. If you make your full focus on hockey, there's going to be a lot of disappointments for a lot of disappointed people. So, and control the things that you can control. I think those are the two biggest things when I talk to other officials that I give as advice. So yeah, those are the two top ones for me.
Great. Mo?
Mine would be to own your future. So the very last slide on the video that was up said, own your future. And that ties into everything. So it's really within your hands to make the decisions that enhance your life, whatever that might be. So if school's important, you need to make those decisions, you need to set those goals, and you need to go after it because it's truly in your hands. Same thing with hockey, same thing with family, the time that you want to spend with people. You really just need to own your future and not rely solely on others making those decisions for you in the search of happiness and goals, but to really dig deep within yourself to find what's important.
All right. Well, Stacy, Mo, we really appreciate all the feedback that you guys just gave us. I know this is something that many of us may be aspiring to or not realizing that it could be something to aspire to. So just hearing your guys' path and experience is definitely very worthwhile. So thank you. All right, Z, move us on.
All right, guys. Thanks, Jenny. We're moving on to penalty terminations. Chelsea and Danielle have that.
Ooh, so exciting, talking about penalty terminations. All right, everyone, all right, wide awake again. So, Zags, if you could pull up our first poll, while everyone is kind of having a chance to read through this, because I believe it's kind of a lot of words on screen, just gonna give a quick intro to this. So, I imagine most people here have been playing hockey or involved in hockey for a while and kind of understand the gist behind stacking penalties and penalty terminations. But the reason we choose to spend some time going over this in our seminar is because there are always these crazy little one-off situations where you just need to pause and think and say, okay, what actually goes on here? You know, most of our games might be spent with maybe two penalties at once at most, hopefully fairly well-controlled games, but then we might have these situations where, say, the person jumps out early from their penalty and scores a goal, and what do? So we want to make sure that we're well-prepared for these types of questions in the future. So some of these are going to be typical ones we might see over time. And then after we go through this poll and kind of see how we're doing here, we can then talk about any of these that we have some questions with. Then we're going to break into breakout rooms so we can actually have some conversation today and get everybody off of mute for a little bit and have some real conversation. Everyone's able to see those. See some scrunched faces on some of the questions, it looks like. Okay. So are we able to close the poll now? Or, because I can't see.
Yeah, we got about 2/3 of them, so.
Let me know.
We'll go 10 more seconds.
Yes, ma'am.
Please.
Perfect. Okay. All right. So we got some answers here. So coincidental penalties, equal number of penalties of equal duration called at the same stoppage. Nicely done, everyone. Glad we got that one correct. Two or more non-coincidental minors being served by the same team. The first penalty assessed is the first one that terminates. So that is true. We have the first in, first out. That does not always mean that you can hop right out when your penalty expires, but we'll get into that. Major penalties never automatically terminate. So we had a couple of questions here on this one. So this is true that they do not terminate. Majors are always served unless they're coincidental, but that's not an automatic termination, which would be like if a goal is scored, you still sit and serve your major. Here's a nice split one here. If a non-coincidental major penalty plus a minor are assessed against the same player at the same time, we want to make sure that that major is being served first for that same reason of it cannot automatically terminate, right? So we want to make sure that this person sits for their penalty. So as long as it's not coincidental, that major will get served first. Another one here with a little split. So we have our arm up for a delayed minor when the non-offending team scores. So the majority of people looks like got this right. You want to report the goal and the penalty, but the offending player does not have to serve it. So since that, since we scored, that's why they don't serve that goal, since there was otherwise even strength at the time. So great, that was a really nice job, everyone. Let's see, we have some questions about majors still, so we'll get into those a little bit more, make sure we brush up on our case books. So now, Danielle, you wanna take it from here?
Great, thank you, Chelsea. So now what we're gonna do is go into breakout groups, and all of the instructors on the staff have some penalty termination scenarios that they're going to share with you. And we're going to have some conversations in smaller groups so everyone can ask questions, participate. And at the end of this, we're going to summarize. So we'll come back together as a whole group, and every smaller breakout group will share their takeaways, what they remembered, what they had questions on, what they're confident in, if something helped them. We're going to all share our takeaways. So we're going to go into groups for 10 minutes. Please, this will give you a chance to unmute yourselves, to ask questions, to make sure your videos are on, and kind of get to know the people you are working with. As soon as you get into your groups, if you don't know somebody, just quickly introduce yourself, and then we're gonna get right to work for 10 minutes. Okay? All you Zags. Hopefully everyone enjoyed having some conversations, meeting some new people maybe.
So many conversations.
All right, for those that were in my room, thank you very much.
Danielle, we have a scenario that we'd like to go over if we have any.
Okay. That was what our point was. Each group was going to have a chance to kind of share out takeaways if anyone had anything, and we'll go from there.
Perfect. Thank you.
Yep. So if you actually, we can start off with your group, Kelly.
Oh, well, I would just like you to run through the scenario.
Because
I think I thoroughly confused my group. So scenario number 5, if you could just walk us all through that, I would appreciate it.
Okay. Would anybody in our group that we were in like to walk us through it? Since we had some conversations on scenario 5 as well. That was the last one we did.
Same.
In the group. That was here, I can throw it up on the screen so everyone can see. And then since I'll lose the participants, Chelsea, if you want to kind of see if anyone has their hand up or wants to talk about this.
I think somebody in the breakout room should talk about it.
Okay.
If Kelly screwed it up, we can clear it up for her.
Okay. Perfect. You want to get us someone?
I took responsibility.
No, because then I don't have a clue how to see all the people. I only have like my little bar on the side.
Okay. Good excuse, Stacy.
Unless somebody wants to volunteer that hasn't spoken today, that would be fantastic.
All right, so this is Jen. You just want somebody to kind of throw some thoughts on this question?
Yeah, on this question. If your group got to it, great. If not, okay. Do it. Just, we had some confusion, so we want to make sure everybody's...
Right, understood.
Jen's okay, so in my group, so I'm sorry, Jen.
No worries, and I'm happy because I wanted this cleared up too. All right, so our understanding is you have B1 who's got a double minor, which by itself would have been 4 minutes if there was no coincidental, and they would have been in the box for the four. But there's a coincidental situation here from the player A. So team B is technically going to have two people in the box, one as a substitute serving one of the minors, and then B1 and A1. Agree so far?
Yeah.
Okay. So A scores. Our discussion was that the substitute for B1 would come out, and that we would be in a 5-on-5 situation now. So our question was, is there only, it doesn't seem to me that there's only 1 minute left for the coincidentals to serve, or maybe it's 1 minute and a whistle. That's where we were kind of confused. So somebody clarify that for us, please.
Yeah. So because it's a double minor, so it's going to be a 4-on-4 situation or 5-on-5 situation. I'm thinking FHL, so it would be 4-on-4. But in USA Hockey, I believe it would be 5-on-5. It would be, so you got a double minor. So and it's one of them's coincidental. And so the team A scores. So when they score that double minor, that first 2 minutes on that double minor would cancel out. So that 1 minute that they have is gone off the board, and it would reset at 2 minutes. So team A would continue serving their 1 minute. So there would be 2 minutes on the board for B and 1 minute left on the board for A.
Okay.
So the answer then being that how much time does B1 have left to serve? It would be 2 minutes, because their first portion of their double minor is now over because of the goal, and it starts then the second 2 minute.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And then when is B1, when is B1 and A1 allowed out of the box?
After whistles.
Yeah.
Because it's 5-on-5 at this point.
Yep.
So B1 and A1 are going to come out at different times. Then A1 only has 1 minute left and B1 has another two.
Yeah.
Yep.
So they're waiting for separate whistles, not the same whistle.
Yes.
That's confusing.
Yeah.
But it's not when you think about the fact that B1 here got two penalties.
Right.
And A only got one penalty. So B should sit longer than A, right?
But technically, instead of having to serve the four, because the other team scored, they're only having to serve a total of three.
Right.
Exactly. Any other, does that help a little bit, Kelly's group?
Yep.
Would that be the same as if it was not a coincidental situation? He's serving a double, 4 minute, they score one goal. It doesn't wash out. It only washes out the first of the two. So he'd correct. Still yeah. sit, he'd sit for a remainder two.
Yep. Absolutely. Okay. Did any other groups have any other questions about scenarios that we wanted to share? Okay, I think I know we have, there we go. So I think we have one more poll, Zags, if you don't mind throwing that up for us to kind of wrap up and chat about the last bit of this for penalty termination.
Polling launched, ma'am.
Great. This ties back to what Chelsea was saying at the beginning, so I'm going to let her talk about this to wrap, take us, finish up our segment.
Okay, so this is definitely one of those ones which will come up at some point in your officiating career. It may only happen once, but it will happen that once, and knowing what to do will be critical. So this situation is that the referee notices that player A1 leaves the box with 2 seconds left. The scorekeeper did not let them out early. What do you do? Let's see. These maniacal laughter there is a little scary. Let's see, do we stop play right away? Do we let play continue a bit? Is this an additional penalty? Is it no penalty? Because it's 2 seconds, it's close enough. I saw a couple smiles at that one.
I think we can close it, Zags.
10-4.
Oh, we were all over the board here. Okay. So we wouldn't necessarily want to stop play immediately, right? If their team doesn't have the puck, if the other team is going down on a breakaway to score and you stop play because someone jumped out of the box early, that's probably not going to go over too well. So we're going to at least wait for their team to gain possession and control of the puck. And now it's this idea of, is this a penalty or isn't it? So I think the majority of us got this right, that this is an additional penalty. This is, I'm a player and I'm just saying when I'm done and out of the box, I am not paying any attention to your rules. I'm going to do what I'm going to do. Well, that's not correct. So we're going to give them that additional penalty. However, if this was a case where the scorekeeper let them out accidentally early, that would not be the additional penalty because that was not their fault. That was us messing up. We're not going to give them another penalty because of that, but they would still need to serve out that remainder. So that third option there about serving the remainder would be true if that was our error. If it's the player doing it on their own, then they serve their remainder, plus now they have an additional 2 minutes to go sit and be angry about it. So nice job there. Very impressed that half of us got it right. It's a tough one.
Chelsea, just as a clarifying question, what would we put on the score sheet for that?
Illegally entering the game or leaving the player's bench is what that one is called. Okay.
So,
question, would we give them the minor penalty if the parent in the box let them out early? Like mm-hmm. if I'm scorekeeping a game?
This is me saying this.
Yeah.
I would not, if that was like the parent just opened the door a second early and let them out. That's not them necessarily. That's not the player really doing that. If it's one of those situations where they just jump the boards whenever they want, that's a different story. So that's a great question and one that we definitely see more often than someone just choosing to leave early. It's, oh, the door's open, I'm going. So that's a great question.
Okay. We will get a roll reference, otherwise back to you, Z. Thank you everyone for doing some penalty terminations with us this morning.
Great, thank you. It was not dry at all. It was the most exciting penalty termination topic ever. So we're going to hand it over to Mo. She's gonna review communication and teamwork, and then we'll go to a break.
Okay, cross your fingers, everybody, that I can share my screen here.
You've got this, Mo. You've got
Thanks, it. Thanks, Megs. All right. Can we see it?
Yep.
Oh, great. Okay, communication and teamwork. So we've touched on this a little bit in a few other presentations this morning. Communication and teamwork starts in the locker room and is very important to get yourself through a game and to work with your fellow officials, but to also speak with coaches, our penalty box crew, and all that fun stuff. So a few things to really think about. Hold on, let me move some people around here because I can't see all my stuff, is to be approachable. So the personality that you bring to the ice can really help through some of these situations. You want people to be able to feel like they can talk to you and that you can go and speak to them and be respectful on both sides. With that being said, though, we want to make sure that our communications are brief and precise so that we get right to the point. We don't want to argue at all with the benches or with the players. We don't want to bait, as Jenny said earlier. So just a brief explanation, what you saw, what you called can go a long way. This communication can really make a difference between feeling like you're working with the teams on the ice and having confrontations with the players or the coaches while you're on the ice. So open yourself up, but do it in a manner that keeps those conversations short and to the point. Be clear when it comes to signals, be accurate. We'll talk about that in a little bit, but your signals can go a long way with getting that conversation essentially going without verbally having to take time away from the game. So communication, very important. Signals, very important. When's the right time to go and talk to a coach? Talking to a coach is important when the players are a lot younger. In a few slides, we'll talk about older teams and players, but when they're younger, it's good to go to the coaches instead of talking to the players. They might not quite understand the whole situation. If it's a difficult situation, so something maybe similar to situation five or player coming out of the box early, like we just talked about, those are times you might need to actually go and talk to a coach and let them know exactly what's happening. But again, knowing what's going on before you go over there. So if you need to communicate with your lines persons, or just take that second to make sure that you understand everything and know exactly what you're going to say is important. We don't want to go over to the benches if we have a coach or coaches that are kind of going crazy. If that is happening, it's a good idea to ask them to come down and let them know that, you know, take a deep breath and I'll talk to you as long as we're calm and can have an adult conversation. And then there are times, again, like I said, that you can talk to a captain, but the younger kids, not always the best time to do that. So, Chelsea, I think you have this one. What's a good example of when a brief explanation to a coach kept the game on track for you?
Sure. I had a really great one at last year's Nationals, where there was a team where they came very close to having too many players multiple times in the first period. Both myself as the referee and the lines persons on the game noticed this, and we had a quick huddle about it and discussed it. I went over and told the coach during the period intermission, like, hey, you guys are getting really close to too many players. You know, make sure that the players are completely off the ice before that new player can jump on and join play, and that anything further would be called. And we told this to both benches as well. And wouldn't you know it, only a couple minutes into the next period, both myself and both lines persons were like, nope, this is a penalty, too many players. Of course, the coach was really upset because who calls too many players at Nationals? And of course, then during that penalty, the other team scored what was ultimately the game's only goal. So yes, that coach got very upset, but had we not had that clear communication beforehand of this is why this, like, this is what's happening, this is the call that's going to be made, and we're going to consistently enforce this the rest of the game. If we hadn't had that conversation and I just started calling too many men, it obviously would have gone a much different way. Of course, we were still a little bit of, you know, heated times there, but it definitely kept the game cooler because he knew what to expect.
Great. Yeah, so key takeaways from that was clear communication. She was straight to the point in letting him know, here's your warning, basically. And then she stuck to that warning and made that call. So even though he would be upset or ended up being upset because the call was made, it was laid out for him. No excuses. That was on them at that point. And then another good takeaway there is that she had that conversation with both benches. So clear and concise, both benches were on the same page and that call could be made. Thanks, Chelsea. That was great. So when do we talk to captains or alternate captains? As the players get older, this is a good time to keep that communication between you and the captains. You'll do this at the referee's crease. And the reason why we like to do that is sometimes, of course, the coaches can be heated, and this gives us the opportunity to give us that distance between us and the bench a bit. And we can give that communication to the captains and send them over to then relay that onto the bench for us. This usually works really well. You just wanna make sure that it's a situation that's understood by the players so that we then don't just have more confusion as we go forward. So if it's still a sticky situation, we want to make sure that we go over to both benches, but a lot of times this will quicken up that conversation and kind of move it on right away. And I'm sure some of you have had those times where the captain comes over and says, my coach just has another silly question. Just pretend you're talking to me right now and I'll let him know. And then we move right on, right? The players even know that the coach is being a little unreasonable. So use those captains. They're a good tool. So let's see, Z, what's an example of good communication with players and how does that impact the game?
Okay. I'm dying to stand up here. Okay. Everybody see me? Yes?
Yes.
Everybody still hear me? I have these brand new earbuds. Check it out. Okay.
Yeah, you're working great. No echo. Okay.
Great. So I'm a linesman. I live most of my life at faceoffs. Right? So a great example, I think, of good communication with players, take advantage of that time that you have at faceoffs. Okay, the referee's doing their thing up there, doing their line changes, and I'm here living at my dot. Okay. And as players are coming in, feel free and talk to them. You know, establish that relationship. You can bring down a temperature of a game just saying, hey, that was a great shot from the point, right? Or, hey, could you talk to your teammates and maybe get these line changes a little bit quicker? Or, hey, you guys are, you know, great hustle out there. I really, you guys are doing awesome. Or something like that when they're coming in. Or maybe watch your sticks. Talk to them as they're coming in. There's nothing worse than, you know, these players, they want to be talked to. They like the attention. So if you're at a face-off, you have your whistle, there's nothing worse than just standing there like this. You know, you're about to drop the puck and you're just waiting for players to mosey on in. Help that referee. They need all the help they can get, okay? Hey guys, let's come in, you know, get set. Talk to them as they're coming. Don't just stand there and then be ready to just drop the puck, you know? Use that opportunity at the face-off to talk to your players.
Perfect. Thanks, Z.
Yep.
So be human with them, right? I'm a referee, so unless it's four man, four women, four officials out there, you can kind of get lonely. So I talk to the goalies a lot, and it's kind of the same scenario here for the linesmen. So be human, chat with them, keep encouraging them in a sense. If we have that rapport with them and they see us as kind of on their side, when those situations arise, it's a lot easier to communicate with them. So I love that, Z. That's great.
Mo, before moving on, we had a question in the chat. So how would you maybe recommend setting that boundary with coaches that might want an explanation for every call or no call?
Good question. I definitely, the first time or two, a normal conversation is fine. If it's interrupting the flow of the game, I'll let him know. Coach, I'm more than welcome to answer these questions for you, but if it's about every minor I'm going to call, I'd love to have that communication in between periods. And you can kind of move on from that. So feel free to come up with kind of what works for you and let your personality shine through that, but don't be afraid to let him know. We don't need to discuss every minor. I'm calling them on you, I'm calling them on them, but we can discuss this and the standard in between periods if you'd like. Hopefully that answers that question for you. We talked about this a little bit, but sharp, clear signals are important in our communications. Making sure that those questions are reasonable. And that kind of falls into that last question I just answered. So there are times where we need to clear up confusion. We don't need to explain every tripping call to a coach. So let them know. Again, the personality to me is really fun. And if you guys know me, I'm very kind of by the book and I don't joke around a lot. So I really enjoy working with people who can find that sense of humor and are really witty and quick on their feet. So use it, but make sure that it's in the right situation so that it doesn't upset anybody. And then again, we talked about this at the very beginning, any abusive or threatening language is not acceptable and we need to make sure that we are on top of things when it comes to calling that. So you can go over and you can talk to those coaches, but the second that changes and they're abusing their role and abusing us, we need to take action. So just a few things to kind of keep in mind, and hopefully we can keep those communications on the lighter side, but use your rule book if you need to, if it takes a turn. Erica, how do signals really help with smooth communication and teamwork throughout the game? Whether it's like Z was talking about with players, what about with your lines mate?
Yeah, so I think that communication, like, nothing's better than when you have, like, you and your line partner are communicating really well. It just, like, you can, you know, bail on lines, like, you know, you have each other's back. But at the same time, it builds that credibility with the players and the coaches that they know that like, you guys are on the same page, you know what you're talking about, makes a game go by a little bit smoother. Kind of same thing, thinking about even just when, like, penalties are getting called with the referee. You can, like, they signal what they're going to call, you can hear it, and then you can get to that player as a linesman, you know, quickly. And maybe then they ask you, what do they call? You know what happened, just so the communication all around.
Perfect. And some of those things are things that you'll talk about in the locker room ahead of time, the tendencies that you may have as an individual out there and how that's going to work for the two, three, or four of you as a team. So communicate in the locker room before you get out there so that it's smooth once we're on the ice and you aren't kind of second guessing maybe what that signal was supposed to mean or the way that they communicated. For a while, my voice was pretty low out on the ice and I had to really work on my voice and communicating loudly so that my linesmen could hear me and hear me efficiently during those calls. So those little things when your partners can kind of give you what they're working on even is really helpful to get through the game and to help each other work smoothly. We were going to do a breakout, but we're running a little behind. So you guys can kind of see this. If there's any other questions, feel free to shoot them into the chat option and over the break or into the next session, I'll answer those. But overall, communication is a good thing, so keep it rolling. All right, Z, on to you.
Awesome. Thanks, Mo. Hey, so we're going to take a 5-minute break here, and I'd like to ask also the staff, we're going to head to breakout room. So staff, if you could please hang on, we're going to talk a little bit.
All right. We're going to just go over this quickly. I know you guys have all obviously officiated before. You're level 2 and level 3 officials. So presumably you've mostly worked in the 2 official system. So we're going to go through a few of the differences for the referees and the linesmen. So I'm going to be going over the referee portion and then Erica is going to be doing the linesman portion. But basically the 3 official system has 1 referee and 2 linesmen. And this is mostly used when you get to the higher levels, like the U16s, U19s, some college levels still use the 3 official system. And just as from the referee perspective, you know, the most important thing is you're out there alone. You're the only one out there calling penalties and you're basically in charge of managing the game by yourself in terms of, you know, the penalties. Obviously you have your linesmen there to help you, but you need to really be in the best position possible to see the goals and to call the penalties. You don't really have anybody else to lean on like you do in the 2 official system. There aren't 2 referees out there. So basically as the 1 official, you're gonna be skating forwards for a majority of the time, which isn't that different from the 2 official system. You can see as the official, you're gonna be 10 to 15 feet behind the play. So this guy right here is following the play, and by doing so, he can see or she can see everything in this triangle. If the official was to be up here, parallel with the play, then she wouldn't be able to see everything. So you wanna make sure that you're following the play and you're not too close because then your field of vision is too small, but that you are close enough to see what you need to see and so that you can get in position. I'm sure you guys have heard of no man's land before. It's this big red area right here. It's basically the area where you don't wanna be and if you can avoid it. Obviously in the neutral zone, no man's land is where you're gonna be in the way of the defenseman and you know the rushes coming. So if you get caught there, you're probably going to go down. Obviously, in the offensive zone, if you're in no man's land, you are in the way of a scoring opportunity, and that's not somewhere you want to be. And then behind the net, if you're in this triangle here, you definitely want to avoid it. You might be able to see the puck go in the net because you're right there, but you're blocked out from seeing anything that's happening in the slot. And you're looking through the goalie and the net and probably a bunch of players. And there could be a big hit or a big penalty that you're not able to see. So basically, as you guys all know how to drop the puck to get out of the way, make sure there's no one behind you. And as the only referee, you're going to skate backwards to the boards and you're going to find your lane. So our lane as the referee is where this line is right here. And that's 10 to 15 feet off the boards. And the reason for that is because of our poor little linesman over here. So if you're
skating,
if you're skating up and down, like touching the boards, you're going to be in the way of the linesman and you're not going to give them any space to do their job. So our lane is basically on the inside of the linesman, just so you have a clear path to skate and to get where you need to be, but so that you're also out of their way. And that's definitely important. I've had a few run-ins with my linesman by being in their lane. You're going to be doing control turns for basically the whole game. There's not much stopping and starting as a referee in the three-man system, which is tough sometimes, but you'll get used to it. So as you're skating and you're going up and down the ice, you're going to be turning towards the middle of the ice. So he's or she is skating this way and you're turning towards the ice, the middle of the ice, so you can see everything. If the official is skating outside or inside out like this, for that split second that you turn your back, there might be a big blow up hit that you don't want to miss. I'm sure everyone's familiar with the golden triangle and in home-based positioning. It really doesn't change in this system at all. You're still going to use this area as home base where you're going to work from. So if you have the play in this corner, this allows you to get closer, if even closer to the net than home base if you need to. So obviously as the play comes behind the net, you can back up. And you always want to keep the players in front of you, especially as the one referee. If you let the players go behind you, and you're not in a position to see what's going on behind you, and nobody else can call that penalty for you. One other thing, as the play is breaking out of the zone, you can kind of cheat in a little bit. So if you see the play is stalled right here, and you can anticipate that the play is going to go this way, instead of standing on home base until the play actually leaves the zone, you can take a few strides up and maybe stand here for a second so that you have those extra two or three strides and you're moving so that you're not way behind the play. These are just some. We know how to do the face-off. We're just breezing through here. All right, the last thing is line change procedure. This is important to communicate with your linesmen, obviously, because they feed off you as the referees. What you're going to do is you're going to give each team 5 seconds to change. So the visiting team has to put their players on the ice first. They get 5 seconds to throw out whoever they want. You make eye contact with the bench, and then you put your arm up. And that means they can no longer throw anybody else on the ice. You then look at the home bench, give that coach an opportunity to put his team out. After 5 seconds, you put your arm down. As soon as you put your arm down as the referee, you can skate, you know, to the goal line, to your position, your home base or wherever it is, and your linesman is then going to do their part of the line change procedure, blow the whistle, and then they have time to drop the puck. It's really not, you know, that different from the two official system, other than you are the one out there. So you always need to make sure that you're in position to see the goals and also to see the infractions. Rick, take it away.
I'd say based kind of what you're just saying, where your ref is linesman's blowing the whistle after the ref puts their arm down. It's something really important to pay attention to, just because it goes back to the communication that with the benches, and because they get confused if they don't hear the whistle, they think they can pull people out there. So it's really important to watch for that. And just that's also a time, like Z said earlier, to talk to everyone at the face-off to kind of get ready. So I guess going as far as the quick video. So this is why, linesmen don't ref. It's a great, you can see really working the blue line, but you shouldn't probably do that as a ref. So just, it's okay to laugh too. we need to play that again because
we're gonna play it one more time, guys. I want everybody to unmute themselves. Okay.
This is Erica, by the way.
Erica has the bands on.
She's our linesman.
And she's a linesman.
And you can see that I'm lining clearly the blue line.
Oh.
Oh my god.
I think the only thing that would have made that better is if you would have called the line.
Yeah, it was wasn't one of my brighter moments, but so we'll get into hey, can you make me co-host on the other one?
Yes, ma'am. Hang on one second.
So I guess while we're getting that pulled up, just as far as lining with the primary and a goal of lining is just that, you're managing the players, making that referee's job a little bit easier because they have, so much to work on. So you're, and pay attention to. So if you can make their job, that much easier by when you're watching the lines, managing what we'll call like those hotspots. So you kind of when the tension's coming up in the game, so where you can break something up and potentially start, prevent something, some future infractions from happening. And so as far as, linesmen, kind of the same thing as two man, just, you don't have to deal with those penalties. You get a little bit more time for yourself there at those lines and really making those right calls. So kind of where we're going to live is, as 3 feet on the side of each blue line here. It's going to be our spot and, just where we're going to live. And like I said, working that blue line, like you kind of saw earlier in that video, making sure that you're on the side of the determining edge and also that you're not in the way of the play. So something to think about when, plays coming in. So say I am standing here. Oops. So I'm over here on this blue line, but plays coming in at me, coming this way. So something to think about as far as your feet, and then that also kind of with your partner, you're always going to want to have your feet in a way that the puck can go through. So you're not flat backing, as you'll hear, as you're doing games. The puck's coming at me. I want my feet to be, parallel to that puck so it can go through and we're not stopping it, letting play advance or going back into the zone. So you and your partner will always have almost that string on you. As you're moving with the play and everything else. So we're lining up here for the game, we're always going to want to line up on the visitor side first, whoever's on that board side, because it doesn't put that favoritism. Doesn't show that you're on that side of the home team. And same thing after goals, kind of thinking about that. Say home bench scores. You're going to want to go on that line up on that home bench side. So it kind of goes back to that communication and thinking ahead of where we're lining up in a face-off, just because you don't want to be on that side, especially if it's a heated game. Getting kind of that backlash from that team that's not very happy they just got scored on. For purposes, too, of a line we're going to – so blue, this is going to be my whole side for half the game. So we're going to stay on those sides. That's our blue line for that half. That's the blue line for Red's half, dropping the pucks all over there. And we'll switch halfway through the second period. So say it's a 15-minute period, about 7:30 through, you'll switch. Unless, of course, there's a penalty power play, then you'll wait till that penalty is over. And it kind of goes back to communication before the game even starts. Talking about, this is when I'm when we should move. That communication of how you like to hold your line. Some people like to hold it. Some people like to bail. But most importantly, especially at this level, you want to keep safe. So it goes back to having that communication with everyone. And then, so as far as kind of face-offs, they're going to look the same as if you're doing two-man. So I know for sake of time, we'll just kind of breeze over it. End zone, neutral zone, you're lined up in the same spot. The only thing to think about in the end zone face-offs, too, is just you're not going to say we're dropping the puck down here. We're not going down to that blue line or the red line after. You're kind of getting out to the boards and skating backwards out when it feels safe to get to your line. And then you're giving your partner the signal that you know, you made it safe, you got that line, they can back up and switch. Now, as far as, let's say we've got the some stoppages here. Those things, they'll look a little different there. So say the puck is stopped here, just a regular stoppage of play. You know, we're going in, but we're thinking first the players, then our positioning, and then we're going to go for the puck. You want to come in, like I said, watch for those hot spots, players at the, you know, in front of the net. Thing I like to do when coming in is just like let them know you're there. It's like, hey, you know, play's done, we're done here, you know, easy guys. Kind of breaks things up. And then you can grab that puck and get ready for that face off. And you know, the top player, or sorry, top linesman, you know, maybe you're coming into the top, you know, circles, hash, maybe you have to go all the way down, just depending on kind of what play is looking like. But ultimately, you're going to kind of follow those players on in to the bench if there's a line change, just to make that nothing happens behind the play. And then kind of look the same thing as far as goals and penalties. Same thing, kind of how you're coming in. The only thing that's going to be a little bit different is so we have a goal. You know, red line's going to pick up the puck. But then as that blue, we're going to say home bench scores. We want to get in front of that visitor's bench to make sure that there's no potential like altercations going on and talking to the bench and more things can happen. So I guess as far as like, yeah, based off, does anyone have any questions with anything that I missed there or confusing? No? All right. Well, then next, as far as positioning, then we can take it back to Z.
Cool. So yeah, usually you might get, you know, moving into the three official system as a linesman. So the Erica's talk was key, you know, and then as you get more experience lining, then sometimes a lot of assigners will feel more comfortable putting you into that ref slot. All right, so we're going to move into some intermediate and advanced video clips. We'll be watching a lot of video, and we'll have Erica, Sarah, and Stacy kind of go over their thoughts on the penalties and the officials' positions and stuff like that. So I guess, Erica, you can take it away.
Yeah. All right, so guys may have to move your little video thing around just so you can see everything on the screen, because we'll take up the whole screen. But we'll just play through it. The video will play through twice, so you'll see the big one, and then it'll kind of prompt you to make the call, and then it'll zoom in a little bit. So here we go. So he's got a quick poll. What would you guys make the call? What's going on here? What would you do?
Well, first of all, are those GoPros on the top of the officials' helmets?
I think so.
That's what caught my attention. which incidentally or coincidentally are not allowed, but okay, in USA Hockey anyway.
So it looks like we got most of everyone's talking about. We got the encroachment by the wingers. They're coming in, you know, coming in. Clearly, you can see the wingers are far past where they need to be, behind the dots or the circles there. So this is a great time as linesman just to talk and take that extra second, because I know he kind of motions them to go back, but he doesn't make sure they totally go back. He just has them stop and not move forward there. Stacey, is there anything you want to add to that?
Sorry, can you start the video? Like what we talked about just from the beginning, just one time.
From the very beginning?
Yeah, just to watch the linesman. And my part for this, wait a second, Erica. My part for this is to go over points of supervision. So if I'm sitting in the stands as a, okay, it's called officiating coach now. But if I'm sitting there in the stands doing it, this is what I'm looking at as you guys are on the ice. So if you just take special care to the back linesman, and I think Erica touched on it, what the linesman does dropping the puck. So when I do my sections, if we can have some interaction, does anybody have one thing they want to say for supervision? What you would say if you were the supervisor? Jump in quick, anybody?
I'm thinking that back linesman's not as engaged. I mean, he's still kind of in motion and circling around.
Right. So as a back linesman, we're going to be right inside that position of the blue line, correct? And then the linesman dropping the puck. Go ahead, Erica. Okay. The linesman dropping the puck does not need to point, because that throws the centers off. Because as a center, you're watching the puck. And if our referees are having, you know, their puck in their hand, they're going like this and trying to get the players to back up using their hands, that's going to really throw off the centers, and especially for higher level games. So let's, as linesmen, let's try to use our words and say, hey, wingers, back up, wingers, back up. So instead of throwing off the centers on a face-off. So, and that stance has a lot to be desired too as a linesman. So hopefully nobody knows these guys.
And just to chime in real quickly too, like Z had kind of said before, as people are coming in, hey, make sure we're outside the circles. Make sure we're outside the circles. So that way you're verbalizing to the wingers. So they already should have some sense of an idea that, you know, this is my standard, right? The circle's here for a reason. Be where you need to be, all right? Otherwise, your center's getting tossed, and then no one wants that. So kind of help yourselves out and verbalize that as that line change is coming in.
Absolutely. Good linesman. If you have a good linesman, your referee's just as good. You have to have good linesmen to control the face-off. That's all I got, Erica. Anything else you want me to point out?
No, I think that's, easy one there. Just get those guys to move back and make sure they are back before you drop the puck.
Are we taking questions after each clip, or are we just waiting to the end? Or is it going through the chat?
I guess we can just do through the chat. Or okay. Are there any questions in the chat?
Questions to the chat for right now, and if there's a big theme, we'll bring it up.
Perfect. Thank you.
All right. So we got the next clip here. All right, so we got our poll here. What are we going to call in this situation?
poll is launched.
Can you play it again?
A few more seconds, looks like most everyone's kind of got these. This same idea here of what we're going to go with. Yeah. So it's going to be a 2 in 10 for boarding. And this is one that, as like it's a lower level game, sometimes it can be hard to look at and see that. But I think with the key in watching this is how far off the boards that green, black, whatever color they are, player is, how forcefully the white player puts him into the boards. Not to mention how much later it was after the puck was released when he hits him. Why we're going to go with more of a more violent penalty call than like maybe a body check. And then we'll go CC of positioning on the refs over here.
Super microphone. Yeah, if you just play the first set of the clips, just pay special attention to the right, stop right there for a second. Special attention to the referee, where he is, his position is right now. And when he comes through the neutral zone and into the zone, that's what I would, that's a huge thing for supervision. Is how he enters the zone.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Anybody have any statements of you that how you would tell this official how we're going to correct him entering the zone? Anybody? Anybody out there in Zoom land? Answer the question.
Keep on skating after you cross the blue line.
Okay, do you know what we call that? There's three different speeds. Well, there's two, but it's used in three different ways. Sprint, glide, sprint. So we're sprinting in the attacking zone, gliding through the neutral zone, and then we sprint. As soon as we get over that blue line, we're sprinting to that goal line. Absolutely. Because if he comes down, Erica, you could play it. If he comes down and goes to home base right there, hopefully he has a little bit of better positioning to see the whole entire play. Okay, so we come across the line, go right to the home base in a higher level game and get to that goal line. Like I think Mo brought it up too, is in position to make sure we call that play. Or maybe it was Cookie. Sorry, Cookie. That's all I got for that clip, Erica.
All right, and then... Oops. All right, next clip.
Dan, this one, we're looking at a goal here. The question that we're asking is, do we have a good goal or not? Get the polls up.
Sorry about that. Hang on.
So while he's getting that one pulled up, again, we'll just replay it so you guys can see kind of that front of the net.
Hey, ladies, we need everyone to answer the polls. Thank you.
The poll that came up was the wrong question.
Yeah, it's the wrong question. I'm sorry. Hang on a second.
It's good. I think I start to see like a little bit of deliberation in the chat here. So while we're waiting, you could feel free to toss some of your comments in the chat as well. Let's see, do we have good goal, null goal? What do we got here, ladies?
You play it again, please.
All right, correct question is up.
It'll zoom in on this one.
How are we looking for responses here?
We're good.
Yeah, we're good.
So this gets, and I think it's interesting that split. For USA Hockey, they're calling this a good goal. But so for some of the people that said no goal, what are we looking at here? What are we seeing? Or what's the determination as to what would make it a high stick versus being a good goal?
A stick above the waist.
Okay, stick above the waist. Who has, what other thoughts do we have?
Depends on who touches it next. Sorry.
All right. Are there any other like thoughts or consideration when we're thinking about is it a good goal or not? Go ahead.
Stick at the height of the shoulders.
Right.
Like is it above or below?
Right. And again, this is USA Hockey. So what's considered a high stick? We're looking at shoulder level. What makes this clip a little tricky is that guy is pretty tall. So, you know, in other leagues, they say the height of the crossbar, but USA Hockey, it's shoulder. So if we, Rick, can we play that back one more time? We got this tall guy here, but when he's making contact with that puck, I know it goes quick, but it's below his shoulder. So that's why they're calling a good goal here, because the stick is below his shoulder when he makes contact with the puck. And there's no portion of the stick that is high at that point. If he, even if like his stick was above the shoulder and it hit his shaft, which was technically below his shoulder, that would be a no goal in that situation, because if any part of the stick is high, and even if it touches below the shoulder, it's the whole stick is what we're thinking about when we're thinking about high stick goals being called back or allowed. But so in this case, since he has it parallel and it's below his shoulder when he's contacting that, we're going to be calling that a good goal.
Stacey, you have anything with positioning on this one?
Stupid mute button. Anybody want to make a comment before I say anything? Anybody notice anything about the referee? Anybody, because I'm going to start calling on people.
He's like non-existent until the very end.
Yeah, I was going to say he's pretty far away from where the play is happening. You can't even see him until after he's already assessed the goal.
I didn't hear any of that.
My thought is that he is back against the boards, but the original shot is coming from that same side of the ice that the referee's on, which is why I think he's out of our field of vision. He eventually moves in, though, as the puck gets deflected by the player in front of the goal.
Okay, I agree with that. The puck is coming from the corner. What is one of the keys that where you guys can look to see how to get to the net? Who gets that puck? Jennifer, who gets the puck from the corner in that clip?
Who gets it as in like retrieving it? What do you mean by who gets it?
No. Where's the puck going from the corner and who does the puck go to?
To the player in front of the net.
No, it goes to the defenseman, right? So it comes from the point. The shot comes from the point. Okay.
So when the
puck is coming from the corner, the referee has to recognize that defenseman is going to shoot the puck, right? And we make our money at the net. So as soon as that puck comes out here, you're going closer to that net, because if I'm a coach
And on this play, especially when there's questions at the net like that, if that referee isn't any, and he's just kind of coming in there like slowly as he does in a second, if he's coming there slowly, as a coach, I'm going to be all, see, there he comes. It's very slow. You guys need to be at home base so you can make that call. So why I was saying this and what I would talk about in supervision is the anticipation of the play, okay? You have to be a half a step or a step above, ahead of the players in this situation, and to get there is right where that referee needs to be moving in. Okay? So position at the net is where we make our money for referees. That's all I have, Erica.
Rico, numeral six.
All right, so number six, we're watching in front of the net.
So with the polls, right, you make the call. We're looking at the goal. What do we got? So let's start to talk about it here. What are people seeing? What are people noticing? What are we going to start thinking about and considering if we're thinking about a good goal or no goal here?
It's my opinion. Good. Go ahead.
I felt like the net was clearly off before the goal, the puck crossed the goal line. I felt like the contact was incidental, knocking the goal off its posts. But so I said no goal, no penalty.
Anyone else?
My thought was red put gray into the post as the puck was going into the goal, because they kind of made contact in front of the goalie, almost like center crease, if you will, and then their movements together went into the goal post. That's how I saw from that angle.
Rick, can you roll it one more time, please? Because, yeah, we're pretty all over the place here as far as our polling goes. So, right, on USA Hockey, it is going to be a no goal. It's a no goal because the post is off here, right? The net is off. I had this yesterday in one of my – it was a late second goal, and the team was down one. They had pulled their goalie. There was like maybe like 2 seconds left as play's happening. Buzzer, you know, goes off, goals in the net. The team's cheering. They think they've, you know, tied it up. But I immediately hit my whistle, right, clear signal. No, the net is off. If the net is off in USA Hockey in a situation like this, where that's not a goal. You can't call a goal. The goal is off. We have no goal. For our 36% people, right, we also don't have a penalty here, because as some people have noticed, the net's being driven off, but it's getting bumped off. Like kind of the two players had come together, and it gets bumped off after the potential goal situation. So it's not like a cross check into the goalpost, which would be a penalty. The two players get tangled up here, and it was displaced due to their themselves like coming together in a hard play at the net. States, thoughts, comments, feelings?
Oh, I don't have any feelings, but I'll make a comment. If we can play the clip right from the beginning, and I want you guys to look at, stop for a second, don't push anything. Look at the linesman, look at the play, and look at the referee. Okay, this clip has a hot mess happening right here, okay? If we can see just right here, we don't have to play anything. That linesman has already been beat to that line. So to what I would say too is that he needs better anticipation off of that back linesman position to get into the play, into the zone before that play does. As linesmen, we must be inside the line, calling that line before the play is. Just like our job at the net is for a referee is at the net is to call goals. As a linesman, you need to be inside that line to call that line. Second of all, watch. You can go ahead and play the clip. Stop right there. Ooh. Sorry about that. Any chance we can go back just like a half a clip? I don't know who's running the clips. I'm a little confused. Okay.
Do you want further?
No, no, that's good right there. That's really good. Okay. That linesman has, look out where he is. He's waving it off way back there. At this point, that linesman needed to continue into the zone and make sure he covers for the referee, because that referee's not even anywhere in the clip in the situation, and there's going to be a shot on net. So that linesman must go down there and cover for the referee. There's three of us out there. At least one of us has to see the goal go in. There's no way that linesman is seeing that goal scored from there, and his job is to cover for there. You, who's doing that? That's impressive. Thanks, Erica. That's impressive. Oh, it's not you. Zach, is that you? No idea. In the land. So if you can just roll it and see how far back the referee is to get a good example. And there we
go.
Here
he is.
Yep. Meanwhile, Sarah's already covered for the referee, picked up the puck, and given the puck to him before he's even getting to the goal line at this point. Is that not correct, Hickman?
With a smile on my face, huge smile.
Yeah, and say, ha, you missed that, but it was a good goal.
That's
goal,
right. I was
whatever
here.
It was.
I got you. I was here.
Okay, and that back linesman would scoot up and cover that line for the linesman that went in. Any questions on there? That was a hot mess. So if anybody has any questions, perfect. That's all I got, Hickman.
Solid. Thank you. So, yeah, just to recap, no goal, no penalty.
And the referee sucked. Just recap.
Yeah, if I would have been there. As a linesman, I would have been there. I was ready.
I know these things. I know these things.
So this clip, we're going to watch in front of the net. The angle isn't the best, but just watch in front of the net. All right, so we'll play it one more time with that zoomed in so you guys can kind of see. What do you think we're going to call here? All right, so it looks like we have a variety of answers. So it looks like the one that's winning here is a minor for cross-checking. So if someone picked that, tell me why we think that's a cross-checking penalty. Anyone who, raise your hand if you picked the cross-checking. All right, so Jocelyn, why'd you pick the cross-checking?
Well, just basically because it looked like the white player just turned, but his stick was up and he pushed him. But I don't know if that would qualify formally as a check from behind. It wasn't like he didn't line him up. He just kind of had turned and his arms were up, and it just seemed like a definition of a cross-check, but I wasn't confident.
The best on it, but as far as like the purposes for this video, what we had, it actually was, it could go, I guess, two ways, depending on how, if he did actually hit his head into the net or not. But the call was actually the check from behind, just because it is that it's forceful. And if he did hit his head on that post, it's going to be a 5-minute game. Because you have no choice at that point. Once he hits his head. So does anyone have any questions with that or any thoughts? No? All right, we'll call back here a little bit then for...
Don't move it.
Okay.
Sorry. I didn't want you to have to work extra on the video. But look at the linesman on the far left, not the linesman closest to us, but the left. That's a bad habit to get into. Linesman, try to stay off those lines, either inside or outside, not on the line. Okay. Am I doing the referee position as well?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. We can run the clip. Watch the referees where he's going to start from the beginning of the clip.
We can't see him there.
You stop right there. Okay. Anyways, so this is kind of like the high stick one. We want the referee at home base when the puck is on the opposite side of the ice. Okay. His distance between there and that other linesman that I was yelling at being on the line, that is way too much distance for them to cover. That puck is across the ice. You need to slide into home base because the shot was on net, goes in. You're right there to make that call, but don't hide in the corner. Okay. And then he gets pushed down the corner. I have no problem with this position here. It's just going to be a matter of anticipation from the play or not. Anything else, Erica?
No, I think that's that.
Okay.
It's good there. Let's see. We'll go into the next play. Kind of watch for something kind of on the middle of the screen to come out. So we catch what happened there. So the watch, there's something gets thrown from the black player on the opposite side.
Oh, I see Timber.
So in this situation, what penalty are we going to have here?
Goal is launched.
So we're kind of almost even here on what we're thinking. We know it's definitely going to be a call. Looks like the penalty shot here, it pulled through and won. You guys are right. It's going to be that penalty shot because go back here a little bit. He's on that breakaway and in the defensive zone when that puck gets, the stick gets thrown. So in that case, because we are in the defensive zone, is when that penalty shot is going to get called.
Erica, if a team wants to take a minor penalty instead of the penalty shot, can they do that too?
Yeah, because you have the penalty shot, optional minors. You'd have to go over to the coach and ask what they would want. Usually they're going to choose the penalty shot.
All right, but Jenny, that is a good point that is an option. And I think it's like one of those like little nuances that can be forgotten sometimes. Maybe that team has a banger power play and they like their chances better on the power play versus having one kid possibly choke on a penalty shot. So – that is something that we have to offer to them.
I have a question. Is that always the case? You know, for any penalty shot situation, do you always have to ask? And then do you wait to signal until after you talk to the coach, or how does that work?
So you're going to signal it that it's a penalty shot, but then you're going to go over to that bench and ask, you know, hey, do you want the penalty shot or not? Because that is always the option. And then just let the other coach know what they chose so everyone's on the same page.
Do you give the option only if it was a stick thrown in the course of a breakaway, not any time a stick is thrown? Because penalty shot wouldn't have been an option.
Right, so fine. So you're meaning like it's thrown because it's he's on a breakaway, or he's thrown because he's in the defensive zone.
It is the distinction because it was on a breakaway, not necessarily the position of the play or which zone it was in.
Well, yeah, because he's on the breakaway, but then also yeah, they takes another penalty in itself if it's in the defensive zone. But yeah, the key was the breakaway.
Right, so if they were in the neutral zone and for whatever reason the kid decided to throw the stick in the neutral zone in random play, that's not going to be a penalty shot option there. Jocelyn, is that what you were asking?
Yeah, I felt like this. It was in the neutral zone. That's kind of why I was wondering. I see that it's a breakaway, but I just thought the initiation of the stick throw was in the neutral zone, even though the stick just kept going.
Right, I think that the big takeaway here is the fact that that player at that point in time is on a breakaway, so that's the lens that we're looking through for this clip for. But that's a great question, and I appreciate you asking the questions. Like, as a teacher personally, I always tell my elementary school kiddos, there's no such thing as a dumb question or a bad question. It's a learning opportunity. I'm sure there's other people that might be thinking the same thing and just, maybe they don't feel comfortable asking. But by you asking that question, we've brought a lot of knowledge to everyone in the group. So thank you very much for asking that clarifying question.
I'd like to actually clarify again or more. For me looking at this kind of stuff, when you're talking about, like, did it take away a reasonable scoring opportunity, right? What I had been taught was that if the putt carrier was, on a plane that was further than any defender, right? And so they could even be in the neutral zone is what I was taught. If somebody does something stupid from behind and there was no other defender after, like, it doesn't matter if they were still in the neutral zone versus in the end zone, it could still potentially be a penalty shot.
Right. Like you said, because it has that's like the definition of the breakaway. It doesn't, they're beyond that, they're near blue line, like their defensive blue line. And this one, he had made that gap, so he was on the position there. That's why. Does that clear everything up?
Yeah, I thought someone had said they have to be in their attacking zone for it to be considered a penalty shot.
Not for the breakaway purposes, no. Yeah. All right, positioning wise then.
I'm back. Right there, perfect. Whoever stopped it. Perfect video. Okay, so this is going back to, do we see the linesman kind of by the guy standing up? There is absolutely no reason that linesman is not inside that blue line to make that call. Okay, making that call and then going straight to the net to cover for that referee. I don't think we see where the referee is, so I'm not going to throw him under the bus. But that linesman 100% has to be inside that line to make that call. I think I just came in halfway, Erica, there you go, yeah.
And also to kind of like piggyback off of what Stacy's saying, and actually Stacy was the one that kind of nailed this into my head, early on in my career, it's not even like acceptable to be getting there the same time as a player. I remember her coming down in between periods, or maybe it was after the game, which was like, you should be able to be there like before they even get there, inside the line, clear vision of the determining edge. You should have time to be eating a slice of pizza before these kids come into the zone. And that's something that's always stuck with me. So when I'm hustling in there, I'm like, Stacy, are you there? No, all right, but I'm doing it. I got it.
You're there. Look at me. I'm here. Yeah, it is super important for the linesman to be there. You know, get a ticket to the game, watch the popcorn, and go from there. And you're in position. No coach is going to argue with, as a referee, you're going to say, hey, my linesman was in the position. So do the little things, like I said, do the things that you can control. Role knowledge and positioning, two things that we can control. That's it, Erica.
All right.
Aren't you glad I came back?
Oh, yeah. Mm. Yeah, you didn't even see the ref in that one, so.
I did what?
There was no ref in that one. It was just the linesman.
Oh, perfect.
If you're going to watch in the corner again, there's a little contact made there. What are we thinking? What do we got here? We got some dialogue going on this. Especially too, if you haven't said anything yet, right? Maybe this is your time to chime in. If you're right, great. If you're wrong, great. It doesn't matter. We just want to hear your thoughts, and hearing your like train of thought could help out other people in the group.
Can you keep the clip playing again? Can we see that one more time? Oh, here it goes. All right, so my thought is, I think there's something I read in the rule book about, you know, when they're getting ready to make a check and they realize they're getting ready to miss the check and they kind of stick their leg out. So my initial thought was leg check, but when I rewatched the video, it almost looks like it's a knee on knee. So I might be changing my mind on that.
Right, and I see in the polling that it looks like we have more people at least thinking along the kneeing realm. So, right, the way USA Hockey is looking at this one, initially we're going to go minor penalty for kneeing. Again, I could see why you might think a leg check at first, but what they're looking for here, it's like the extension out, kind of like you had mentioned, Jen, of that knee. So we have knee-on-knee contact. So they're looking for a minor penalty for kneeing. However, right, if that player gets injured, then that's when we're going to a major penalty plus a game, again, if an injury occurs. So on this particular one, I think they're viewing it as not an injury. However, people who kind of took that next step, you're also right as well, because in the event that player is, like, not getting up, the trainer has to come off, or you're blowing the play dead because a player looks injured, that's when you, as an official, need to be thinking, all right, initially, like, I have a penalty, I have kneeing, which would be a minor, but now this kid isn't getting up, or, like, that's pretty bad. And again, initially, right, you're just saying, calling kneeing. Maybe you wait to see as that player is heading to the box. You're stopping, thinking, replaying what's going on, and you're surveying the ice. So you have that opportunity. You don't need to yell out whether you have a minor or major right away. You're making your signal for the knee, and then you kind of read the ice, read the play, and then by that point, you've bought yourself a couple extra seconds to determine whether you're going just a minor for kneeing because the kid, like, skated up and off to his bench and he's all right, or if they're down on the ice, or if a coach or trainer needs to come out, then that's when those little, red flags should be going off in your head that, all right, this is a little bit more severe. I'm going to have to take a step up and go major game for a knee.
Right. And to take your time with the assessments, you know, that guy's obviously going to be down for a while. So we had Jocelyn ask if it could be a standalone major and then add the game for injury. So you're not going to immediately just run to the box and say five for kneeing. And then, oh, he's still on the ice. Okay, yeah, game is misconduct. You know, stand there with your partners and check out the situation. Use that in your referee's crease. You don't have to just rush in assessing the penalty. So he's down. He has to be helped off the ice. Then you can go ahead and with confidence that you have five in a game for kneeing instead of changing, you know, it's just a bad look.
Stacy, thoughts, comments? I know you don't have feelings, so just thoughts or comments.
Yeah, exactly. Well, I really would love to, Hickman, but if you play the clip, let's talk about what officials we see.
None.
Oh, hmm.
That's my point, people. That's my point. Okay. And if this was happening in a game, there's plenty of people on here that can confer what I would do. I'd be video clipping, maybe not this actual situation, because I probably wasn't smart enough or fast enough to videotape it, but I would look at first period and a trend and seeing what you were doing and what how you're doing things. I guarantee I would have a clip just like this, and I would have started my sorry.
Like that.
I would start out my evaluation with, here, look at the iPad. Tell me where you are. Is that not true, Hickman?
Yeah.
I'm just saying. Okay. Yeah, no. Super, super important, people, that we do our jobs and be at that home base and make sure that we're there. And especially with the puck, again, across the ice. Again, it's a theme. It's a theme for the videos. So that's kind of how I would approach the supervision. Anything to add, Erica? Because I really, there's no officials there to talk about. So, but I was trying to, that's really what I wanted to bring up in that situation.
There's nothing there. And that was all the clips too. So it's on to you, Stacey, for the mentoring.
Oh, so now it's all me about mentoring.
Can I just chime in really quick? Because there was a lot of chat about that clip in the major plus game or standalone major. And I do wanna just really quickly clarify that when we see this happening out there, instinctively for USA Hockey guys, this is a minor or a major. We're typically going to take it to the next level for the game misconduct if that injury is happening. This is not, or if you think it was reckless and deliberate, that's where you would think maybe the match per se. But we're not going to jump to major game off of this. USA Hockey wants, for at least this specific call, us to consider minor, major, and then if there's the injury, we go with the game misconduct. Also, this is a good conversation to have with your partners on the ice. If you're not sure if it's a minor or major, it was kind of borderline gray area for you. Call your partners in and say, hey, this is what I saw. What do you think? You know, and make that decision together.
And especially too, then like when you go to the coach, if like the coach is upset, say like, listen, I hear you. However, it's like we got together as a team and collectively talked about it. This is the outcome we came up with. So especially from a coach's point of view, it looks better when if there's going to be a controversial call, that you guys got together and talked as a team. Coaches want to see that you're not just kind of making your own, like, you know, quick decision. If it's going to be something where they're either going to be down for 5 minutes, or if they're down for 5 minutes and just lost their kid, the coach is probably going to want some clarification. And if you can reference, you know, getting together with your partners, that's really going to help you out.
Yeah, there are four, you know, we know there's four main penalties that carry the minor automatic miss, major game automatic. The kneen is not one of those ones. Thank you, everyone.
Okay, now that you took 4 minutes of my 5 minutes of mentoring up, I only have 1 minute of mentoring talking about, so I appreciate that, people. Yeah, my topic is mentoring, super exciting. I don't really have much other to say than do it. We're in it together. We have officials that need our help. You guys are level twos and level three, so you have the experience. When we were talking in a group of staff members, you know, I didn't really realize what Nick was saying is that think about level one seminars. You guys are sitting behind a screen just like this. And when you were level one and you did this, the first time they're going to step on the ice to be an official is right after a Zoom call. They don't get any on ice stuff through a seminar like this, like we usually go on the ice and show them. They're stepping out there fresh new officials. Take it upon yourselves to tell your local district or local assigner that you want to be a mentor, especially for another woman, another girl. Okay, you know how important having somebody there that understands why you're there and how you're there, and a younger official that's a female, I think that's our responsibility as a whole group to help them, carry them, and bring them up, okay? So maybe our next staff meeting, our next seminar, will have 60 women in it, okay? That's our goal, is to, we're here. We didn't get any paycheck to be here. We did it volunteer today because it's important to us. It's important to us for you guys to get the information. Now it's your turn to take it out and give it to somebody else that needs it. But it's a new program through USA Hockey. I know Z wants me to talk more about the details, but just do it. Just be helpful. Just be a good coach. Just go use your friendship skills. Help people on the ice. Okay, it doesn't have to be just a girl. Level one, make it everybody's goal to go and do a level one coaching situation this year, at least one game. Z, do you want me to talk anymore?
Yeah.
No, you don't want me to talk anymore. No. Look, it's 12:30. Boom. We are all done. We caught up.
Yeah,
we're hungry. They have something to do on a Sunday afternoon. I think football's coming on, isn't it?
What's football? We don't know what football is. Hey, everybody. Thank you so much to you guys. I mean, this is huge. I'm so excited to see 30 new ref, not new, but you know what I mean, 30 female refs out here. Also, thank you to all the instructors. Kelly, Erica, Kelsey, Danielle, Mo, Stacy, and Sarah, and Jenny. Thank you so much for taking the time out of your day to do this. And hopefully, you know, I've been inspired by probably everybody on here in different ways. Zags, do you have any parting words? Fall risk. Oh, boy.
Who put this on my car? Okay, I want to know. No, I'm so glad everyone was able to join us. We only had a few bumps of the road, but I think we pulled this off pretty well. This by far has been the best one we've had all season doing the Zoom bit. But
I got something to add to that, Nick. You know why, right? Yeah. Do you want me to tell you why it was the best run Zoom meeting ever of all time?
Why is that, Stacey?
Because women organized
from you.
Women organized it. Just saying. You
yes,
all
were ma'am.
It, I'm just going to tell them.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, we will send, I think Zach sent most of you the closed book exam information. We also have the roster. Please feel free and reach out to me or any of the other instructors. If you don't have their contact info, you kind of saw where we're from. We're from different districts and states. I can send you, I will be happy to share their contact info with you. Yeah, please reach out, and we'd love to be a resource for you guys.
Does everybody understand how the closed book testing will work? Do you want me to go over it one more time just in case? Yes, okay, good. All right, so here's how this works. And probably within the hour or so, I'm gonna verify the attendance. Okay, and then clear all that up and then send the seminar off. Once everything is submitted, within about 24 hours to 48 hours tops, you are going to get a link sent to you from USA Hockey. All right, that is very similar to the link to your open book exam. Okay, and here's how this works. The link is only going to be active for 7 days. After 7 days, your link is going to expire and you will not be able to take your test. And then that's going to be a mess for your local supervisor. Okay? So if you run into any of the link issues, I need you to contact your local supervisor. All right? And then I also sent links to to the webpage for all of your local supervisors. I did that last night. All right, once you click and initiate your exam, you have a 3-hour clock, You have to finish your exam within the 3 hours and you can't stop. Okay? So what you need to do is you need to book 3 hours with yourself. Okay? And so when you get that link, within the 7 days, click on that link. Once you click on that link, you have 3 hours to complete your exam. Okay? Any questions, feel free to hit up the chat on that. Also, your local supervisor can help you with all of this stuff.
Dags, real quick too, you're not allowed to skip questions. Is that correct, right? When you're taking it, you can't skip questions?
My seminar isn't coming up till next week, so I do not know that answer, but I believe that to be true.
Yes, you can skip questions and come back. Over on the one side, there'll be an indication of which questions you have already answered. And if they're not all checked off, you'll see the ones that you haven't answered yet. But you can go from one to another and come back. You don't have to answer them in order.
Great.
And it shouldn't take you 3 hours. You know, that's just the time frame they gave you. So don't be afraid that it's going to be a 3-hour exam. No different than in the past.
All right, since we're all starving, I like to talk about the next topic will be diet. Be going over health for lunch. I think that's it. Any more questions?
I was just going to say thank you. You guys did awesome. This really was very well coordinated, I thought. And yes, I am totally asking for contact information because, like, I need support. I don't work with other female refs. Like, I need that support and I will reach out to you with things. So, you know, I actually want to know, like, where you guys are and be able to reach out to you because I don't see any other female officials. I don't even see my own officials unless I'm working with them. We don't have meetings. We don't have anything that we see each other, so it's very much isolated. So if I need support, I'd really like to be able to reach out to you guys. So thank you so much.
Thanks. All right, you are dismissed. Thank you so much again. And I'm happy.
Thank you.
Season. Steph, you could please hold on and just
thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks everybody.
No.
Thank you.
Oh my God.
Good job.
Remove.
Goodbye.
Bye.
Man, Thanksgiving at the Z House must be pretty tough.
Hitting.
Sue, you are dismissed. Do you have any words of wisdom?
I have no words of wisdom other than you guys did a great job. Well done. You clearly worked really hard to coordinate this, and we need to do more of this. It's fantastic. And Z will talk.
Cool.
Yeah, I think if you're looking...